That's what I was going to ask everybody.
Are you ready?
I know. I should really get the hell out of here. Why? All right. Well, let's do it. Damning us all directly to hell. Once again, Marilyn Manson.
Marilyn Manson's no originator. No one ever talks about the music, just the image. Many people see them as an Alice Cooper rip-off merchant. And like Alice, makeup is the max factor. I mean, you must remember Alice.
I liked Alice Cooper growing up. I think a lot of people have said we're the Alice Cooper of the 90s. I think that's a fair compliment, really. I think he did a lot of great things in his day. I think Marilyn Manson's probably a little more dangerous because it's so much more real to me and to our fans.
Now, you thought Alice Cooper was weird. You thought Alice Cooper was out at the edge. Wait till you see this man, Marilyn Manson, 28 years old. His name is an amalgam of Marilyn Monroe and Charles Manson, his two great opposites, you see. His band members are named after serial killers. In the United States Senate, they're trying to have him banned. They're so disturbed by him. Young people flock to see him all around the world. He's a shock rocker. He calls himself the Antichrist Superstar. He invites the audience to spit on him, or has done in the past. There are chickens and blood everywhere on the stage. Marilyn Manson had a very interesting upbringing, very religious upbringing. Went to a Christian school. He got beaten up in the neighborhood for going there. Then he went to a normal school, which he wanted, and then he got hell in the neighborhood for having gone to the Bible school. The Christian imagery, he says, gave him nightmares as a child. He describes his childhood as one of isolation and fear. And I met him today at an old graveyard. Take a seat down here, Marilyn. This is a very nice cemetery, a very old cemetery. We thought you'd be happy in a cemetery.
Reminds me of New Orleans.
The cemetery?
This past summer, yeah.
That's right, and you dug up, you went robbing graves there. Did you rob graves there?
We didn't rob them. See, in New Orleans, the ground is very deteriorated, so you just find bones sticking out of it. So we just plucked them. So we didn't actually rob them.
So should mums and dads be worried about you?
I think the best thing that could happen is if parents are afraid of me, they will take more time to raise their children to be more intelligent so that they can decide whether or not and how music, art, and film is going to affect their lives. Parents are afraid of losing their youth, and there's a bit of a jealousy sometimes when they see their kids identifying with something that they can no longer relate to.
What do your mom and dad think of this?
They're big fans now. I don't think they always were, but they see that I enjoy what I do. I think that's what they want more than anything.
You would have struck some controversy with the name Manson, in the States particularly?
Well, one of the points of the name was to almost a mockery of controversy, a mockery of the phoniness of show business, you know. But I thought it was interesting to take those two because of their history in popular culture, how America has put them on the same status. They're equally memorable, you know, for those separate reasons.
But in that, too, on those two names, there's also that opposites that you're constantly talking about.
Yes.
All right.
So it was a perfect metaphor for me.
Yeah. It scares the heebie-jeebies out of the middle classes, too, doesn't it? Out of the Bible group, too, I would imagine. Manson.
Yeah, it seems like the people who are open-minded enough to understand, you know, we'll find something enjoyable out of what I do, whether it's entertainment or whether it's something to believe in or whether it's something to tap your foot to. And the other people who aren't open-minded enough, I guess, really deserve to be scared because the fear is what's, you know, keeping them from understanding it. Fear themselves, usually.
Is this all a game, do you think?
It's not a game, but it's definitely something that keeps me entertained. Yeah, I'm as entertained by the way the world reacts to me as the way, you know...
The world is entertained by you.
Entertained by me.
Well, you don't seem particularly scary at all, if I may say so. Is that disappointing?
Well, Well, I think the scariest thing about me is that there are different sides to what I do. You know, that, you know, I'm sure if there were a devil and you were to meet him, he'd be quite charming, I'm sure. I don't think he would, you know, set you on fire right there on the spot.
Fascism doesn't always wear jackboots.
Personally, at the moment, I'm afraid. Because I don't know if you and I will be able to stand up after sitting for so long on this concrete grave. Ah!
But if you'd like, we could try and dig up some bones, but I've got to go eat lunch at some point.
Well, that's right. I've got to get back. That's right. Well, I'm sure it'll be fun to do. Well, good luck.
Thanks. Enjoy it.
And I think with our new record that we're working on now, it's subtle in more ways, but the message is more powerful. Maybe less offensive on the surface.
What do you think the message is? If there is one that you could...
Everybody's going to pick their own, but I think I like to tell people the way I see the world, and if they can learn something from it, then that makes a difference. But I think the bottom line would be to be what you want to be and don't try and fit into something that everyone else wants you to be, you know? The world is as much as you want to make it, you know? And if you want to make it your way, that's the way you should make it.
Are you ever aggravated at misinterpretations of your work?
No, because, you know, confusion is also a great form of communication.
Mm-hmm.
So, at least if they're talking about it, that's important. You know, that helps me to evaluate myself when I think about the things that I do in my life and stuff, you know, because I can go from times where, you know, I'll experiment with anything, and then I go over times like today where I feel completely grounded. And sometimes, you know, when your whole life is so chaotic, when it's in control, it's sometimes more interesting than when it's chaotic.
Mm.
Like a lot of people will say, you know, when they've been doing drugs all their life, if they're sober, they feel more screwed up than they were when they were on drugs. Mm. Same thing kind of applies. Mm.
News of the Antichrist's first known visit to Oklahoma City sent Capitol busybodies into seizures and quickly reached the office of the governor, ex-FBI man Frank Keating.
From the standpoint of a parent, the standpoint of a public policy maker, it's important for us to say we're not going to shut you down by law, we're not going to shut you down by the writ of the censor, we're going to shut you down because what you propose is not uplifting. It's not helpful. It doesn't advance the culture.
It's always been art and music that has changed culture. You know, whether, you know, it's his perspective, whether or not it's uplifting. But if it weren't for people like me that stood up for things like freedom of speech, people like him wouldn't be allowed to voice his stupid opinion in the first place.
So what was the upshot of all this moral ferment? Did Marilyn Manson and company wind up shredding puppies on stage or biting the heads off live babies? Of course not.
Is a Marilyn Manson show a show that a, you know, father and son can go see together? Or...
My father comes.
I'm proud of all you motherfuckers for showing up.
It's when you take away things that kids enjoy is when you cause problems for them, you know? People always think that heavy metal or rock and roll has always been the source of the problem, but it's when you deprive them of that is when they start to get bitter.
Meanwhile, in churches and Christian coffee houses around town, the faithful prayed for the souls of the accursed star and his fans.
We need to pray for Brian Warner, the leader of the band. We need to pray for the band members. We need to pray, guys.
This hasn't brought your life to an end or anything. You're okay?
No. Oh, I'm fine.
What did you make of the show?
I thought it was really great, and I really like Marilyn Manson a lot.
Would you agree with that pretty much?
I would agree. I think it's sort of stupid that they made such a big deal about it.
Music that's alternative now for me is stuff that people just would despise listening to. I find myself listening to Lionel Richie and Dr. Hook.
Yeah, what is it that you that ropes you into Lionel Richie?
I don't think there's anything more evil than you know, me and my bandmates sitting around before a show singing Hello by Lionel Richie. I think that's the heart of darkness. It was a character that I had to portray. This is everything I always wanted to be since I was a kid.
You're not going to do what David Bowie and the guy from Marilyn Manson into something else then, like you?
Okay. Oh, there's always Antichrist Superstar.
Now, that's the transformation you undergo on stage, right?
Yeah, it's the album is translated into the show, and it's about it's a statement about the totalitarianism of rock and roll, how people respond to superstars. It's a lot of things to think about. It confuses some people, it scares some people, but I like to make people think so that they walk away and that they may have learned something about themselves.
Is that some hocus pocus you're cooking up there, Tiki? See, it's gone out.
Bunkbed pirates?
Bunkbed pirates? Is that you all try and get up on top, or what exactly is that? Is euphemism for some herd of erotic behavior?
Usually, when we're not, well, there's live mice and things like that we like to put in one another's bunks.
Like Nosferatu, you travel with a lot of rats wherever you go.
Actually, I thought it was Richard Gere.
I think that's gerbils.
It's more like the Pied Piper, that they just follow our bus.
Right. So do you ever play any tricks on him, like, because he's always hitting everybody else on stage?
Tricks?
Yeah.
Serial tricks, I don't know what you're talking about.
Sometimes, tricks. I'll toss a condom. He doesn't know what that is. I put that in his bunk. See if he'll use it.
Oh, it's in this evening. Hence the gloomy feel to the whole show. But what I'd like to know is, you know that thing we were talking about you playing up to people's opinions of you? Is that quite a big joke for you? Do you find that quite funny that people take you so seriously?
Sometimes, you know, it depends. The music is very sincere, and so are a lot of my ideals. It's just when people start to sensationalize things, I usually just like to add gas to the fire, because most of the time they don't know what they're talking about, so you might as well make a fool out of them if they're, you know.
And just sell a lot more records in the process as well.
That never hurts. I mean, it was, I just wanted to really tap into different parts of your subconscious that you wouldn't normally find, and I just did a lot of reading, a lot of, you know, about the black magic and voodoo and things like that, and there was a lot of times when we stayed up, you know, many nights, just experimenting with all sorts of drugs and things, and finding how that affects your dreams, because when you go to sleep, then your dreams are more intense, and all the lyrics on the album were really inspired by the dreams and nightmares that I had over that period and the few years that preceded that. Mm. So I mean, the result really is the album. I would never go back and do it again, you know. Mm. But I'm glad that
did
I did.
Why did it scare you, then?
No, but it was something that I learned from, and I learned that it made me a stronger person. It made me have more control. You know, when you come so close to danger, that it kind of makes you appreciate life more.
That kind of, like, voodoo and all that kind of stuff, like magic, also shows you that you have much more power than you really know and than you use, you know what I mean?
A lot of my theories on magic are related to art, because I think artists are, like, the true magicians. They always have been, whether it's a writer or a performer or whatever you might be. It's I think the things that you create and how it affects people is magic, more than anything.
That's true. But did you ever go on like a science and stuff like that? Like, you know, the voodoo, how they have those, how do you call them, when they dance around and the
spirits
and the chicken and stuff like
well,
that?
Well, through all my experiences, rituals tend to be created for people because they don't have the confidence in their own mental power.
Mm,
and
true.
Because we're raised so ritualistically that you feel like you have to go through some sort of procedure in order to do something, when a lot of times it's just the simple power of your will that can make things happen for you.
That's true. You've got to learn that. So what's the deal with you and Satan? If there is a deal.
Oh, if I made a deal, I did pretty good. But
you know, I've always considered God and Satan to be, you know, like your left and your right hand, just mm-hmm. like Marilyn and Manson. Mm. You know, I don't even get mad, but it annoys me when people say that, you know, I'm a Satan worshiper and things like that, because it's kind of pointless. I mean, if there was a devil, he would be worshiping me because I'm much more successful than he is these days. But it's, I think it's just a man had, you know, has to create things like that to help understand himself. But I have a great understanding of myself, so I don't need something to worship, you know. I feel like there is greater powers in nature, but you work with them, you don't serve them.
Mm. But don't you hate it that people always say, just because of your appearance, they say, oh, you know, devil, and they, you know, tell the kids, you can't go and see this concert, you're too young for this, you can't go there, you know what I mean? Doesn't it bother you sometimes that you call, like, you're so judgmental, you know?
Well, it does, but at the same time, it kind of creates another power in itself. Because I try and expose people to their fears, and if that's one of their fears, you know, hopefully they'll get a better understanding of it.
Mm. And, like, do you believe in life after death?
I'm open to the idea of it. I mean, it would be interesting to... So many people are so concerned with what happens to them after they die, they don't enjoy living while they're here. So, I mean, all of my, you know, affinity to death is always to get a greater appreciation of life, it seems like, here and now.
Hi, how long did you spend in the studio making this album, and which do you prefer more, the studio or being on the road, and why?
We spent about 6 months in the studio trying to transcribe tapes that we had made on tour, and over the past 5 years, a lot of dreams that I had that I wrote down, and we spent a lot of time you know, almost torturing ourselves at some points, trying to put it all together, because the album is a bit of a ritual in some sense to bring about the apocalypse, and whether that's in of the subconscious or of the real world, that's up for everyone to decide on their own. But we spent you know, 6 hard months of sleep deprivation, drug experimentation, and all sort of pain rituals and things, trying to tap into the subconscious and find this record. And when we were done, you know, it was a great weight off of our backs.
Your new CD, Antichrist Superstar. Maybe I was hoping you'd tell us why you've broken the CD into 3 parts, and also what some of the symbols mean around the lightning bolt.
Well, 3 is an important number for us. You know, the core of the band has been the 3 of us. And there's 3 parts in my life story. That's what the album is, past, present, and future. That's what the 3 parts are. The symbols have a lot to do with numerology and Hebrew Kabbalism, some of the rituals that we were experimenting with when we were recording the album. In context of the last record, was about, you know, almost going against the whole world and how that can make one person feel. And it was the existential idea that if you want to destroy the world's just really in your head. And people have interpreted it as, a suicide.
Killing yourself, yeah.
Right, but...
Destroying the world by destroying what's in your head. How
right.
To destroy what's in your head. Blow it away.
Right, and it's inspired by stuff that I read when I was a kid in high school, you know, in philosophy class. And, you know, I'm just trying to express myself. I've never encouraged anybody to hurt themselves in any way. I've always encouraged people to live every day to the fullest, because you might not be here tomorrow, you know. I think my fans truly understand that. I've always said, express yourself, be who you want to be creative, and don't let people tell you that it's wrong, you know, just because it doesn't agree with their morality. I think it's always been part of my nature growing up to question the popular opinion of the mainstream, And Antichrist Superstar really is an album about just that. I mean, it translates beyond just being against Christianity. I mean, here, I think in Japan, people can relate to it on terms of, you know, questioning the popular opinion. But it's an album about searching for something to believe in and going through religion to relationships to drugs to power to music and finding in the end that you can only believe in yourself.
We're here to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to the lost.
America was founded on principles that are about God, about the Mosaic Law, and those things are which are right. And there's forces that are tearing those things down.
What I do isn't that different from what someone does in church on Sunday. I have a vision of the world. I get up in front of a large group of people and I say it, and they pay to see it. And I think they do the same thing in church, and it's interesting because one is considered more righteous than the other, but it's only because of popular belief. Right and wrong is just, you know, what's popular. It's not really have anything to do with morals in the end.
There's a holy war going on, and they're on the wrong side. They're on the losing side, in fact.
I feel sorry for their lack of intelligence and their closed-mindedness. I almost look at them how, you know, most of mankind would look down upon apes as being a lower form of intelligence. I don't expect someone who is so closed-minded about their religion to understand me, because I think that I've evolved into a different level that's beyond their experience, and it's something that you can't explain to people like that. They have to find it on their own. I can't try and make them understand why I think the way I do. They're not capable of understanding it. Family wasn't very religious, but they sent me to a private Christian school. And there I started to form my opinions and discover the disillusionments of America, the underlying fascism of Christianity and of television. As a kid, I started to see that you're made to feel guilty if you're an individual, or you're made to feel like if you have an opinion that's not the popular opinion, that you're wrong. I've always thought that the American dream was sort of a joke, because you're taught that capitalism allows you to be better than the next guy if you work hard enough. But at the same time, you're raised to believe that everybody is created equal. So you grow up being very confused as to what you're supposed to do in your life. But I think your willpower is the only thing that you can hold true. And if you want something bad enough, your determination will give it to you. You can't count on the rest of the world for that. It's something that you have to will to have. To me, Satanism represented a satire of religion, the ability to criticize things that you see around you, the ability to believe in yourself. The word Satan was, to me, adopted because he represented the ultimate rebellion. I've never seen it as a religion or as anything to do with worshiping the devil or anything as ridiculous as that. If you were to sit down with every person you met on the street and you described these exact ideals, I think most people would agree with them. You know, there's nothing wrong with believing in yourself. There's nothing wrong with wanting to believe in a God because you're afraid to go to sleep at night or you don't know what's going to happen when you die. The only thing that I think is wrong is when people use that fear
to suppress others and use that guilt to extort money from them and extort behavior from them. And that's really the thing that I've tried to, you know, say. Everything that we do naturally as humans is wrong. And I just think people should accept what they are and enjoy it. You know, I think there's always absolute morals. You know, everybody will agree that you should basically be a good person and try not to hurt other people. That doesn't mean that you can't have sex and do drugs and enjoy what rock and roll is about at the same time. To me, Antichrist Superstar also said that, in a sense, rock and roll is just as blind and fascist as religion is. And I myself could be compared to a televangelist. But I think if you know that and you acknowledge the hypocrisy of everything, then you can kind of go beyond it. In a world of lies, you can become at least the most enjoyable lie. You know, my vision is that everybody expressed themselves in some way or another. I don't try and point people really in either direction. I have, you know, criticized Christianity, but I haven't tried to point people somewhere else. I've just tried to take something, tear it apart, and expose it to people so they can make their own decision about it. I think that's just an element of pop art to the extremist form, and that's what I think that's kind of the basis for what I do. By using something and criticizing it at the same time, you create such a powerful paradox. It's something that most people are afraid to do. With fascism, I use the imagery to criticize it. And you've got thousands of people chanting against something while at the same time being a part of something else. I think it creates something very beautiful and interesting. The same with drugs, same with Hollywood, same with glam rock and decadence. I live there, I live it. I know it's fake, I know it destroys you, and I criticize it, I talk about it. I don't think that you can be a genuine writer unless you do something. You can't just sit back and look and say, well, that's wrong. You have to experience it to know that. And then you tell people about it, and then they either live vicariously through you or they go on to experience it themselves. And it has changed the way people look at things where they first might have thought it was disgusting or disturbing, and now it's intriguing to them. They actually take the time to understand things and discover and investigate the references to literature that I like to make and to films and things like that. It kind of opens up a world to them, so I think that they feel like it's almost a teacher-student relationship in some ways. A lot of people, you know, think that our fans are just as mindless as, you know, religion and things of that nature because they show up at the shows dressed up like me and things like that. But I think that's really their way of feeling like they're a part of something and expressing themselves.
People make up stuff every day, you know. You order some chicken on the rider to eat, you know, and then the next thing you know, you're mutilating, you know, ostriches on stage.
Those are the type of things that people created to try and have a reason to hate us. Because if you basically break down what I'm about, it's what rock and roll has always been about. And what I'm trying to say is just to live your life the way you want to and, you know, fuck the people that don't want you to. I think people didn't want their kids to hear that. They want their kids to stand in line and behave and to not speak out. But they had to create a lot of other things to say why I was bad. And I disproved those, and now I'm just here to do what I do, and they can't do anything about it. But I don't think parents understood what Elvis Presley was about either, or the Beatles, so it's nothing new. You know, I don't think I'm any more controversial than they were in their time. It's just times change and things become more extreme. And I consider everything that I create to be art, and I don't find most of it to be offensive. I think that it's provocative, but I think the images that I use kind of reflect the way I feel and reflect the music. And it's sad that some people can't appreciate things on that level, that they have to look at it as ugly or offensive when it's intended to be something to stimulate. I'm not sure if it's more positive. I think it's more decadent. It's more flamboyant. And that has always represented something darker to me. I think when something's obvious in its intentions, like Antichrist Superstar, I think, was more forward and more provocative because of the title alone outraged people right from the bat. With this record, I think it's a little more subtle, a little more dangerous, in that you have a bunch of people walking around a shopping mall singing a song like The Dope Show, not realizing what they're saying. I think in some ways that's more, what I've always wanted to do, because I think it reaches people in a way that they didn't expect to be reached.
We're all stars now. In the dope show, we're all stars now. In the dope show, they love you when you're on all the covers. When you're not, and they love another.
I said everything I could say about religion. There was no reason to continue to say it. You know, I talked more about the idea of drugs as a metaphor on this album. And not just the obvious interpretation of it, but also how people use different things to subdue or to dumb down their emotions. Religion being one of them, television being one of them. You know, even the power of fame being another. Particularly on television, there's such a hypocrisy when it comes to drugs, and people think that if drugs are used for decadence, they're worse than if they're used in the commonplace. That because a certain drug is illegal, that it's worse than a drug that's prescribed. But I think you'll find that often people that are on prescription drugs or that are meant to like make them behave a certain way, it's just as dangerous as someone that buys it off the street. It's just that the government hasn't been able to control and sell it themselves. Antichrist Superstar was a cold, very mechanical transformation that reflected what I was trying to do in my life, trying to become something superhuman. And when I got to the end of that and finished writing my book, I found myself starting to feel again for the first time. So this record is kind of a two-part look at becoming human again in a place like Hollywood, which is the most inappropriate place. So seven of the songs are very sarcastic, glam rock approach to what I was feeling at the time. And the other seven songs are kind of the darker thing that lies beneath that. I think there's a complete change that happened all across the board. And I think, to me, I attribute it most to the fact that Antichrist Superstar was meant to be a transformation. And I think it succeeded in that. I think I took things to an extreme in so many different parts of my life that it was time to be reborn again and start over. And that in turn led me to have a more of an open mind towards relationships with other people. You know, I tried the idea of being in love. I think maybe some of that's reflected on the album. Maybe just through the idea that I think there's a lot of times on the record that feeling human emotions like that seems very scary and very hopeless. And I think that's probably the most personal I've ever gotten in anything I've written. Well, the more I began to feel, the more I saw the rest of the world as being cold. And I looked up the word android in the dictionary, and it defined it as being something that looked and acted human but had no soul. And if you set science fiction aside, that kind of described everything I saw around me. So mechanical animals was the name that I had for the people that surrounded me, and the idea that the more man creates with technology, the less relevant he makes himself. You know, eventually computers will think for us. Our cell phones will have conversations for us. What all of the science fiction writers and people have always feared, and where all the stories have come from in the past, that man would eventually make himself useless. But I think the only bit of hope that I look at on the record is that if one day machines were to replace mankind, they would eventually realize that you can't replace the human soul. So they would have to start over and start making humans again to try and find the soul. So I think, in a way, Mechanical Animals is strangely a spiritual record, if you disregard all of the nonsense that goes with the word spirituality. It's really about me finding my soul, in a way. Thing that is in most danger of replacing religion is just man's own desire to destroy himself with technology. I think science, in a way, has disproved the existence of God. but in a way it's proved an existence of a new God, and that's mankind. And it's there's no worry for Big Brother, because there's plenty of little brothers, and we're watching ourselves, we're destroying ourselves. It's just all eating itself. That we had learned something new all of a sudden. In fact, pieces of these songs had even come up when writing Antichrist Superstar. It was just the approach when working with a producer like Trent Reznor. His approach is to subdue and to suppress melody and to make things more harsh and abrasive. So this album we wrote with just me producing in the beginning. And we recorded most of it on our own in my house. And then we brought in the producer, Michael Beinhorn, at the end to help us finish it and put it together. But I think this record kind of shows what the band's about. This is the first time when we really came together as a band. I think it was probably not having the influence of a producer that made this record happen, because we just did what we wanted to do, and there wasn't anyone trying to steer us in any direction. I had a real clear vision of what I wanted to say. And the very two distinct pieces to the story. And we wrote seven songs that reflected one side and seven songs that reflected the other. And I don't think that was something that I could explain to someone else, so I did it myself. And I thought that when we brought someone in at the end, they could see the whole picture and they understand it. And, yeah, it works. All these things that had a sense of fantasy and had an imagination to them. I think that's something that a lot of people don't bring to music anymore. No one approaches it as an art form. You know, it's just more of a product. And I wanted to remind people that I think if you're a true artist and you put your heart into what you do, then you take it beyond just the music. You know, you put it into every element. Exaggeration of decadence is more just a sign of the end times, and not a sign of anything really liberating. It's a sign of the abuse of liberation in a way. What I saw in Hollywood. Well, that's kind of me documenting the feelings coming back into my system on the record, and feeling like the idea of whiteness is just kind of the most empty feeling of all. And maybe that's why things are reflected with color a lot on the record, or it's something that I mention a lot. The name and the song Come a White was the idea on the album, what I'm trying to find to put the two parts back together again. You've got one half of me that lives this exaggerated life, and the other half of me that's suffering to stay alive, and the thing in the middle is coma white, and you know, it's either the drug, or it's the girl, or it's either the part of me that I can't define. And that's kind of the story that I hint at.
Rated X.
Welcome to the Launchpad Podcast.
Motherfucker!
I'm Zach Long, and welcome to the Launchpad.
Today on this episode of the Launchpad Podcast, I will be covering the last piece of Marilyn Manson's triptych in a summary video that will explore a couple different possible interpretations and double meanings of the entire unraveling story, while also showcasing the way I view it personally based on the information I presented in this four-part video series. If you have not watched the prior videos, you absolutely should do so before watching this one. That way, a lot of the most important information and references to what I'm about to quickly gloss over have their proper weight of importance based on the fine-tooth comb approach of the other triptych videos I made. So I will put a link to those videos in the description below. Now, my basis for thinking the way I do on it mostly stems from an irrefutable tarot card Easter egg found in the Holywood album's artwork that essentially lays the groundwork for probably the closest thing you'll get to Manson revealing the significance of the trilogy to you himself. Without the tarot being read, you can still absolutely understand most of it, but a pivotal piece of confirmation will go 100% unnoticed. So the second part of this video will include me doing a tarot reading based on the album artwork of Holywood and the cards revealed within it. And you'll see during that breakdown how it's such an important piece of the puzzle. And lastly, within this video, I will finally answer the biggest question of this entire trilogy: is Adam's rebellion revealed in Holywood just a singular story, or is he the same character all the way throughout Antichrist Superstar? So it's time to dig in. Feel free to grab your favorite beverage as I'm getting ready to start the first part of the triptych story arc, which, as most of us know, begin with Holywood. Now, I'm going to say it one more time, just in case somebody just discovered Manson or has not seen the other videos yet. Even though Holywood was the final album to be released, after the trilogy was complete, Manson revealed to his fanbase and through the press that Holywood is actually the first part of the story, and the trilogy should be interpreted in terms of chronological order in a backwards fashion. So that means part one is Holywood, so I am going to begin there. The whole reason the tarot card is even involved in this explanation is based on Holywood and its artwork. If you were to take the artwork booklet of Holywood and fold it in a certain fashion, it would reveal to you the sequence of the tarot card spread that I will be digging into in much greater detail towards the middle to end section of this video. But to kick things off from a storyline sense, the character we follow within this record of Holywood is Adam Cadmon, whose name is generated from the first symbolic and idyllic man as notated in the Kabbalah, and also functions as a semi-autobiographical version of Marilyn Manson at a younger age. Adam was raised up in this imperfect world of ours, with his idealism and hatred towards hypocrisy and superficiality that the establishment which has oppressed him keeps shoving down people's throats. This leads him to start out and create a revolution. This part of the story is mostly conveyed in the A-side section of the record, entitled In the Shadow. This section contains the first four tracks: God Eat God, The Love Song, The Fight Song, and Disposable Teens. But as we eventually discover, his revolution becomes corrupted, sold out, and turned into a product that is marketed. After a while, Adam inadvertently becomes part of the establishment himself because he was baited by its flawed luxuries. Therefore, he ends up becoming what he grew up hating. So now I'm going to dig just slightly into a more track-by-track rundown of this album. And as I said before, I'm starting with side A, In the Shadow. Track 1, God Eat God. Now, within this song, the lyrical phrases here question the purpose and power of God, JFK, and religious symbolism altogether. Essentially, boiling down to the question, is someone at a godlike height of power, influence, and success after they've been tragically killed? And if so, what example does this set for a culture that embodies these sentiments? This lays the backdrop for the conditions of this society of Holywood that the first part of our quest takes place in. Track 2, The Love Song, was inspired by society's obsession with guns, the outdated values of America, and what Adam/Manson believes are its three core principles of guns, God, and the government. All three categories mentioned have potential to both help and hurt, and this song dives deep into this reasoning. Religion, government, and guns can have a responsible, even worthwhile use at times, if executed in a proper manner, but can just as easily be misused abused and dragged down the overall quality of a society and its inhabitants as a result of its corruption. On this album, our main character, Adam Cadmon, is an individual who feels he has a great power within himself, yet he's being suppressed by this culture which worships violence and has no separation between religion and the government. These qualities affect him both in the form of negativity and also inspiration to form an alternative to the status quo. Now, not only does it get revealed that Adam's rebellion is not a purely holistic personal mission to save people from the worst aspects of Holywood, but a multifaceted, sometimes confused and conflicted, cause that also includes trying to use a gained influence as a way for Adam to appeal to his seemingly unattainable love interest, Coma. Coma has deeply entrenched roots to Holywood and the guns, God, and government way of life, since her parents are the rulers of this nation, and they collectively make up a sort of first family. And this information is revealed in its greatest detail in Manson's Holywood novel, Chapter 10. You can still find Chapter 10 on the website mansonwiki.com. So if the information I'm about to talk about or just talked about is news to you, feel free to look that up and read that chapter for yourself, and that will provide a much greater understanding of some of the background information contained here. But moving along, Adam, on paper, has no chance to fit in or get close enough for a shot to win Coma's affections. But he does not let that obstacle deter him from using his willpower and growing influence to prove that he's worthy of her. Adam has to claw his way out of being an outcast or lower class based on how you look at it. This societal propaganda of guns, God, and the government reaches a breaking point with Adam, and he kicks his rebellion into a full-fledged counterculture that is most notably pointed out in track 3, The Fight Song. The fight song is where Adam spews up all the poison he's been spoon-fed by the Holywood mind-control death-worship culture. To him, it's not a realistic representation of what's going on. It's only a tool for those in control to maintain their power and influence. Therefore, his ultimate aim becomes to burn it all down. And this leads us to track 4, Disposable Teens. On Disposable Teens, Adam further condemns Holywood's hypocrisy and begins attracting a sizable movement that morphs into a viable contender of opposition, threatening the established law and order and forging a new status quo. Adam is someone who is trying to turn people on to bigger ideas, which will potentially lead them to mistrust everything society, the government, and the corrupt elements of a religion have told them in order to maintain control. When that day comes, their power by deception and force vanishes. Adam is trying like hell to make that day happen as soon as possible. It becomes clear that something has to change and will change. Now, whether that change is something positive or negative becomes more and more complicated as the record continues into the second segment, which is the Androgyne. Now, this segment we're about to get into spans from track 5, Target Audience, all the way to the end of A Place in the Dirt. Track 5, Target Audience. Target Audience dives into comparing mankind's nature as imitative and doomed to pass blame along towards scapegoats instead of finding both purpose and responsibility within themselves. This sentiment is reflected on both Manson in terms of how he's looked at in our society and also in the story of Holywood with how Adam is treated by his culture as well. They receive death threats and blame and are asked to apologize for their behavior. Meanwhile, the ruling class and society at large is responsible for the violence and systemic problems that keep circulating. This further drives the point that thinking for yourself and acting as an individual is considered an act of violence or sinful in this particular social climate. Target Audience concludes with shedding light on the concept of being a copy that the world has created based on spoon-fed ideology and encourages everyone to break out of this crippling thought control. Which leads us to track 6, President Dead. Now, President Dead continues with Adam/Manson's mockery of the media's obsession with violence in order to gain ratings. This song also explores the broader importance to JFK's significance in the land of Holywood. JFK is worshipped as their messiah. His skull being stained glass is a strange substitution for the crucifix in terms of an idol connecting you to a messiah. This is Adam/Manson's way of comparing these belief systems to a version of a dolled-up death cult. the references to pills are used to illustrate their purpose as a numbing agent to prevent rebellion. Also, the lyrics of Don't Want to Live Forever captures how they are conditioned in this culture to be more valuable dead, hence suffering or death is preferred over prolonged, uneventful life. Track 7, In the Valley of the Shadow of Death. What's funny about recording this while there's a thunderstorm going on outside, I remember hearing an interview with Manson where he reveals that they recorded parts of the album outside during a thunderstorm. So I thought that was kind of like an interesting synchronicity between talking about Holywood and how they made the record. But track 7, In the Valley of the Shadow of Death, has Manson singing about outcasts and how people that are viewed as failures in society have no hope that anything will change for the better in the future, so they just plunge into their pain and misery. Metaphors of heaven, which represent happiness, that is only suitable for the quote-unquote normal people, excluding the misfits. Now, story-wise, this is where Adam voices a desire to be king, so that his way of thinking could be validated. Therefore, he would no longer feel alone. However, Adam's ultimate conundrum begins here, with this line of thinking. On one hand, he hates societal standards and how they try to make people think and feel a certain way. Yet, here, he is only feeling validated if he's surrounded by people who share his viewpoint. So they reveal themselves to be kind of one and the same. So this essentially points to the fact that Adam is in the midst of a crisis, as he's finding rebellion can make you even feel more alienated than he may have felt prior to taking a stand against these things he does not believe in. The track ends with poetic phrasing of, "She put the seeds in me, plant this dying tree. She's a burning string, I am just the ashes." In that poetic stanza, she references coma, both the girl in the story, and also the more broader real-life metaphor, which is the desire for love, perfection, and acceptance. The seeds are the inspiration for his rebellion. Plant this dying tree peels back thoughts of doubt Adam has about this process being a no-win situation. If she is a burning string, he's just the ashes. This reveals to us how Adam's self-worth is crumbling. Compared to his love interest Coma, he is nothing. She and the rebellion are the only things that provide his life value or yield any reason to look towards the future. But despite Adam's depression in this track, he does not stay knocked down for long. He gets back up with an even more aggressive drive and focus, leading us to track 8, Crucifixion in Space. Now, track 8 showcases the concept of failed evolution, monkey being the first phase, which gives way to mankind, which gives way to violence. The line, Adam of Eden being the bomb, aka Adam Bomb, is a metaphor for this album's protagonist setting out to destroy the world of those who have created the society which has oppressed him. Pull my knuckles down if I could, plays on the line from track 1, God Eat God, Dear God, do you want to tear your knuckles down? Revealing to us that Adam is starting to feel his quest of revolution will, or already has, put him on the same level as gods or other objects of worship. Lyrics introduce the idea that tomorrow, aka the future, is canceled because of the problems of the past. They only can transcend this dilemma when they are martyred, therefore becoming spiritual saints, ascending to Holywood's corrupt idea of a heavenly pantheon. This takes us to track 9, A Place in the Dirt. On track 9, the Matrix code is revealed to be broken. Adam and his rebellion are exposing the flaws of their suppressive surroundings. The control of Holywood's ideology is starting to slip in numbers in favor of Adam's efforts of opposition. A section of lyrics that can quickly point this out would be, "Put me in the motorcade, put me in the death parade. Dress me up and make me your dying god." This circles back to the Holywood societal death worship aspect of the story, with Adam's proclamation of "Make me your dying god." As in both, Adam is worthy of being on that same status with JFK and others worshipped under the umbrella of celebritarianism, which is Marilyn Manson's idea of the worship of dead celebrities. He even trademarked the word back in the day. And also, it shows how deep his revolt goes. It's a cause he is willing to die for. Which leads us to the third part of this record, entitled Of Red Earth. Track 10, The Nobodies. Today I'm dirty, I want to be pretty. Tomorrow I know I'm just dead. The nobodies wanna be somebody. This lyrical section acts as an easy example that displays the attitude and viewpoint of Adam, the Death Valley Rebellion, and its low rung on the ladder of circumstances. They are nothing, and the most they can strive for is to break through to Holywood, die, and be worshipped as a martyr afterwards. Leading us to track 11, The Death Song. Track 11, simply put, is a metaphorical representation of Holywood. Adam would like to end it, because deep down he knows their ways are corrupt, and even the followers of the Holywood ideology would probably welcome a change if a good enough case is made for an alternative. Hope that heaven's true indicates that Adam's take on heaven, or the direction society and his cause should be aiming towards, is an idealistic pursuit that may fall apart when actually executed. Therefore, they hope it's true and holds a valid purpose. They sing the death song because they were not given any real options to start with. They wanted to be accepted, wanted to be like you, as in the pretty ones of Holywood. Yet now that Adam has been making revolutionary waves, the Holywood folks seem to be shifting focus, perhaps for the first time, snapping out of the mass hypnosis they were under, finally turning to a new hero, Adam. Yet they see this as a double-edged sword. They want to wipe the slate clean, but doing so will most likely destroy everything, including themselves. However, they still want to be like Adam. They still want to rebel, despite the risk. Track 12, Lamb of God. Christ in the Metal Shell, or Holywood Worships Death as a God. And the press, and their media coverage, will make you a god, because that's how Jack, or JFK, became sainted as a deity in this culture. Lamb of God is a phrase used in a few different ways to convey a sacrifice to appease God. In the land of Holywood's twisted ideology, Mark David Chapman created an angel by murdering the legendary Beatle John Lennon. If you die when there's no one watching, and your ratings drop and you're forgotten, if they kill you on their TV, you're a martyr and the Lamb of God. Nothing's gonna change the world. Nothing's gonna this criticizes society past and present, or how they found a way to turn even Jesus Christ into a marketable commodity. He literally dies for his cause, trying to better humanity, and the best mankind could do in return is worship the image of his death via the crucifix more than his actual message. This further draws upon the concept of the media creating gods, legends, and heroes. If you speak or act loud enough and it grabs the media's attention, you will be in the club. Your name will live on. But if you fail to make a big enough bang, you will be forgotten. A startling but true parallel to not only Holywood, but our culture today. Track 13, Born Again. In Holywood, Manson takes the concept of being born again and applied it to the idea that one can transform themselves continually by the accomplishments of their work and their influence. This also was played upon in Antichrist Superstar of a cyclical timeline and recurs in Holywood with the illustration that metaphorical death is a necessary step to rebirth, a cyclical depiction of the regeneration of life. An example of this that affects the entire triptych is found in this album's liner notes, which revealed that this song, Born Again, was recorded at the same time as the first song on Antichrist Superstar, Irresponsible Hate Anthem. This recording supposedly took place on Valentine's Day, 1997, despite this album, Holywood, being released in the year 2000. Adam/Manson is questioning the reason behind his followers. Are they down with the cause due to sharing similar beliefs, or are they simply following along for the ride since it's the new trend? This pinpoints Adam's drive to eliminate the status quo and forge a new way, proclaiming even if he dies before seeing its completion, he will be born again, since the principles he's fighting for are of an even higher purpose than his own life. In this record story, around this point, Holywood is now equal to or being infiltrated by the Death Valley Rebellion. This war of ideas has taken its toll and changed Adam into something new, but unfortunately, it seems like it's trading one prison cell for another. His followers, philosophical process, and revolt are showing their own flaws and pitfalls, which brings us to track 14, Burning Flag. Adam's revolution was initially ignited by a drive for change, and also out of his own feelings of worthlessness and self-destructive tendencies thanks to his environment. Now we come to find they want to sell out his revolution. Adam recognizes that no matter how hard he fights, there will always be corruption, always be the crabs in a bucket mentality to keep you down. This quicksand commercialism is sucking him in. He's being adored and losing his edge because he finally got what he wanted, a sense of belonging. And this takes us to the final section of this record, The Fallen. Track 15, Coma Black. Mouth Growing Lies further paints the picture of the corruption setting into the rebellion. Drunk on power and status, Adam is now reflecting on how his revolution, originally built on integrity, has fallen like a castle made of sand. The love he was fighting to find, the acceptance, the status, he obtained it, but he's beginning to realize when all your wishes are granted, many of your dreams will be destroyed. With hindsight being 2020, he may have found an alternative to go after what he desired, on more mature and stable terms. He finally broke the barriers between Death Valley and Holywood, was able to prove his power to himself, to society, and to his love interest Coma. He begins coming to terms with the fact that what he has fought for has introduced a new set of problems. Some personal, some societal, but not he, nor Coma, or his followers will make it out unscathed. Coma White was track 14 on Mechanical Animals, and Coma Black is track 15. And just as Coma White represented a moment of grand realization in the saga of Mechanical Animals, here it happens again. The revolution is becoming a corrupt shell of itself. The perfection of Coma, Adam's highest idealism to strive towards, has proved to be at least partially synthetic after all. A new transformation must occur, one that cleanses everything and everyone from not only the dirt they crawled out of, but a total crash and burn of Holywood, the Rebellion, and himself, leading us to track 16, Valentine's Day. this track functions as a related backdrop to the conundrum facing Adam and Coma. The idealism of their romance has given way to harsh reality. Their union will not be accepted with open arms due to their opposing worlds attempting to forcibly tear them apart. A lot of speculation revolves around the lyrics about the pregnant girl in the song. Theories, mine included, open up the possibility that this pregnant girl is actually Coma. And we can suspect the possibility that the seed she's carrying is the worm from Antichrist Superstar. The song flirts with the idea that in death, we are remembered much more glowingly than we were in life. And if you are famous and killed in the spotlight, it acts as a form of immortalization. First flower after the flood illustrates a rebirth concept of sorts, which indicates Adam being an ancestor or a reincarnation of the worm character in Antichrist Superstar. Adam must experience the flood, but the worm will be the one thrust in the aftermath. So here, the worm in Antichrist Superstar would represent the flower, but the flower will only sprout after the fall. Track 17, The Fall of Adam. Adam and Coma are in the midst of a horrible situation. Their alliance and rebellion is being met with backlash from the powers that be, which are hell-bent on either killing or converting them. When one world or ideology ends, such as Adam's revolution, it goes out with a whisper rather than a scream. Or others who want to oppose the system become afraid they could be made an example out of next. Therefore, the cycle continues on of being suppressed until someone throws the gauntlet down and forms another round of pushback. Powers that be in Holywood are representing their mantra of guns, God, and government over and over, almost in a form of brainwashing, trying to convince them to repent and also forge an example that rebellion will be stomped out. They want mothers and fathers to bear witness to what's happening, to drive the point home that their way is the only way. The track ends with a buzzing horde of flies, which foreshadows the coming of death, leading us to track 18, King Kill 33. The title of this song is a nod to the novella manuscript King Kill 33 by James Shelby Downard, which is a manuscript which paints the narrative that JFK's murder was essentially an esoteric ritual, historically known as the Killing of the King. Jesus Christ was also crucified at the age of 33. In the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry, the 33rd degree is the highest level you can achieve. It is a degree by invitation only. You are selected based on your ethic and dedication in relation to Masonry. The highest level of dedication one could have in relation to their beliefs is a willingness to sacrifice oneself for them. Jesus Christ did just that. He ultimately sacrificed himself for his beliefs, which creates another piece of the puzzle of King Kill 33, which focuses on the sentiment that Adam is now going through the same thing. He's either going to have to bend the knee and change under the weight of Holywood's elitist regime, therefore failing his revolution, or he's going to have to die for his revolution. Leading us to the final track on Holywood, track 19, Count to Six and Die.
She's got her ass up in my idea. She's got the dirt and spit of the world. Her mouth on the metal, the lips of a scared little girl.
On track 19, Coma is on the verge of taking her own life, rather than being forced back into the lifestyle of celebritarianism. If she cannot be with Adam in an honest and pure, affection-filled way, if she cannot live life on her own terms without a tyrannical interference from her family and society, then she'd rather die than continue on living a watered-down life.
And it spins around.
Two, three.
And we are laid down.
Five, six.
Some do it fast and some do it better. Smaller amount, and it spins around.
Two, three,
and we are laid down.
Five, six.
Some do it fast, some do it better and smaller amounts.
As Coma spins the revolver moments before taking her own life, the sound of fireworks, which have been a long-standing celebratory version of the bombs of war, can be heard in the background. This indicates that an all-out war is underway, Holywood versus the rebellion. Coma, being a long-standing staple born into the Holywood culture, does not want to fight any longer, and after witnessing both the potential promise and backlash of consequences towards the rebellion, she would rather go out on her own terms than continue being caught up in the crossfire. Now, this record does end before the final gunshot from the spinning revolver is heard, which leaves the fate of both Adam and Coma up in the air. I found it interesting that the final track involves Coma being referenced instead of any direct references to Adam, which unfortunately leaves us with more questions than answers. Notice a similarity with the background vocal counting.
And it spins around.
Two, three.
Now compare that with the track on Antichrist Superstar, Crypt Orchid. Notice how each track has very similar styles in both vocal delivery, and also they never reach the number 7, which is a metaphor for heaven and peace. Therefore, I believe this final track, Count to Six and Die, does indicate that Coma does die by taking your own life. And therefore, so does Adam's revolution. It dies too. Since she was the highest ideal Adam was striving for, the main purpose of fighting so hard to break out of his cage of containment, this would make a lot of sense to me in terms of why Manson has revealed statements in many interviews, such as how on this record, the major takeaway is no matter how bad you want to change the world, the only thing you can do is change yourself. And also a statement he made regarding the influence of the term coma on mechanical animals, that she's an unattainable entity that Alpha/Omega keeps trying to come in contact with. If Coma in reality is dead, and Adam's revolution has fallen apart, and Mechanical Animals is the sequel to Holywood, then Alpha is Adam after changing himself, and Omega is his hollow product of a revolution being cleverly marketed and sold to the people that he once tried to enlighten. If we play detective with not only the clues on this album, but its correlation with the other two entries of Mechanical Animals and Antichrist Superstar, we find what I would consider a relatively solid roadmap of the final outcome, which brings us to the second record in the trilogy, Mechanical Animals. Mechanical Animals is, in a sense, a dual album. Half of the songs are sung by the Alpha character, who is idealistic, sensitive, and emotionally affected by the world around him, and the other half being Omega, who, along with a fictitious band entitled Omega and the Mechanical Animals, focus on much more superficial and surface-level styles of rock and roll rebellion. Now, these superficial sex and drug anthems are essentially what Adam's rebellion has malformed into, just like the quote from the Antichrist Superstar song, "Dried up, tied up, and dead to the world," you cut off all of your fingers and trade them in for dollar bills. If we look closely at the artwork in Mechanical Animals, that statement seems to fit Omega as well. Even with some of the promotional photos released with the record showing the Omega character with prosthetic red fingers. To me, this is a dead giveaway that the Omega side is a purely commercial entity, while the opposing Alpha half of the album deals with the internal conflict of this dichotomy of ideals and coming to terms with a past that cannot be brought back. Alpha being the counterpart of Omega, who is essentially the personified rebellious character in Mechanical Animals, is ultimately who Adam evolved into, thus illustrating the verse in the Bible, in the book of Revelation, "I am Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." And that is from Revelation chapter 1, verse 8. Alpha slash Adam was the beginning, or chapter 1 in the triptych, and Omega is the ending or conclusion to this thread of the story. Part 1 in the trilogy revealed to us not only the failure of Adam's revolution, but also the death of Coma. This spins us into interesting territory if we look at Adam as a surviving character in the aftermath of Holywood's events. What do I mean by all this? Well, Alpha in Mechanical Animals seems to be chasing the dragon of Coma, for lack of a better term. And at numerous times in this record, it calls into question if she is a real woman he's romantically linked to, or if Coma is some sort of an unattainable high he's after. But if we view it from the lens of Coma being dead, thanks to the clues on the track Count to Six and Die that concluded Holywood, we could potentially be witnessing a tragic romance torn apart, leaving Adam slash Alpha cast out and commercially repackaged as Omega, a superficial, rebellious product with no actual revolution taking place. Now, with this split of Omega and Alpha, we can see from the lyrics and just the overall vibe of the music contrasting with the two sides of the record that Alpha is the true side and Omega is just the show for society and the fans. And even the name Alpha is not much of a stretch from Adam word-wise. Also, the biggest smoking gun proving that Adam is Alpha is contained on the Omega version of the Mechanical Animals artwork booklet. If you turn this cover upside down, you can see in bizarre microscopic font writing that reads, "Adam number 5. So, I don't want to hear any contrarians in the comments acting like I'm making shit up about Adam surviving the events of Holywood or people calling me a genius among men for figuring it out. It is literally on the fucking artwork of Mechanical Animals. Now, Adam/Alpha has a hole inside that he cannot fill. Raw emotions like the speed of pain, where he's using an excessive amount of drugs and a hedonistic lifestyle as a means of trying to chase the feeling of his love and his connection with his precious coma, long after she's already dead. I know, it sounds incredibly romantic and sad, like some Romeo and Juliet shit. So I'll give you a few seconds before I continue, in case you're tearing up and need a Kleenex. Okay, that is long enough. It's time to dig into track one on Mechanical Animals, A Great Big White World. With this video being more of a wrap-up, condensed walkthrough, I have not utilized many music clips that feature lyrics, since that was already covered in full with my last videos. But in a few specific cases, I think it is still valuable to show them, as it helps provide examples of some of the connections I'm about to draw, with this transition from Adam to Alpha being one of them. This is extremely important, being that Great Big White World is the first track that connects us from Holywood into Mechanical Animals. In space, or Holywood, the stars are no nearer, and they glitter like a morgue, which sums up the death worship culture and the hollowness of Adam's experiences in Holywood. He dreamed he was a spaceman or something different, perhaps even a savior, only to be cut down or burned, and his world or rebellion was gone. The Holywood celebritarianism-influenced society is, in Alpha/Adam's point of view, dead of emotion, much closer to androids than in touch with legitimate human souls, hence the title of Mechanical Animals. Low prescriptions and itchy stitches point to the changed appearance, damaged psyche, taste for drugs, and longing for coma that has befallen Adam since the conclusion of the Holywood album. He wishes he could have coma even one more day to ease the pain of being in this agonizing existence without her. Now, a thought that came to me in regards of connecting the Society of Holywood to Mechanical Animals is in terms of perspective. The beginning of Holywood featured Adam almost looking over the fence from Death Valley to Holywood, witnessing it from afar until his revolution brought notoriety and eventually blurred his world with theirs. On this album, though, we find Adam slash Alpha being repackaged by this elitist society as Omega, a surface-level rebel that only portrays a revolutionary, but in actuality is part of the Holywood establishment, while Alpha's songs give a more reflective social commentary on being within the system of Holywood. He realizes that all these celebrities and death worship icons aren't stars, but mechanical animals, kept in check by their greed, quest for fame, and drug dependency. It's as if, when he was finally integrated into the system, his interpretation of these circumstances vastly changed. Also, time could be another factor in terms of the differences between mechanical animals and Holywood. There is no clear indication, official or otherwise, that clearly explain how much time has elapsed since the events of Count to Six and Die concluded and the great big white world picks up. It could be a few months, a few years, or perhaps even a decade later. To me, this remains as one of the most debated elements of the three-part story. And in my eyes, you can make a case either way. But as Manson has explained in numerous interviews, Mechanical Animals explores the idea that mankind's desire for more and more technology eventually overtakes the need and importance of having a god or a religion, and once that behavior keeps continuing, it essentially creates another form of worship, with technology being the new god figure. So instead of having a Zeus-style God the Father or Christ-like figure in the sky, seeing you when you're sleeping, knowing when you're awake, so be good for the good Lord's sake type of idea, those same traits of an all-knowing, all-seeing, quote-unquote God begins to rest on the shoulders of a big brother type of technological takeover, where a new age-influenced artificial intelligence takes the reins from the old-time religions. For this societal transition to occur, I believe it would take quite a bit of time. So in my own personal view, if I would have to bet on it, I would say Great Big White World takes place at a minimum of a few years later than Holywood timeline-wise. I view it as Mechanical Animals being the result of the failed rebellion and the government and religious culture war that Adam's revolution spawned. After the death of Coma and the integration of Adam being co-opted by the powers that be of Holywood, the establishment decided to repurpose his rebellion as a further means of thought control for everyone else. So the followers of the rebellion more or less numb themselves out on the celebratory feeling of being rebellious. Meanwhile, any real threat of changing the system is swept under the carpet. Under this viewpoint, Adam missing Coma and remembering the times of the past and trying to replicate those feelings of purpose and belonging become much more desperate in an interesting way, storyline-wise. It gives us further backstory and meaning to this odyssey that he finds himself on, trying to recapture something that is impossible to bring back. And this is where we are in this artfully awesome series of events, leading us to strap into the passenger seat and let this war of inner thoughts and feelings, clashing with the realm of flawed expectations, take us on a sci-fi-laced psychedelic trip. And now you may be asking yourself, well then, what is the first stop on this trip? Well, it just so happens we have tickets to the Dope Show. Track 2, The Dope Show. Now, The Dope Show functions as the theme song of Omega slash Alpha's public persona, and its lyrics feature predictable subject matter for the rock genre. Much like the band Kiss's mantra of rock and roll all night and party every day, The Dope Show is about the excesses of rock and roll, sex, drugs, and all sorts of other taboo. The band of Omega and the Mechanical Animals have rabid followers who, as revealed in the music video, are so fanatic that they riot under the hypnosis of this catchy song. The Dope Show is a metaphor for the hollow nature of both real-life celebrity and celebritarianism. The pretty ones of the society and his fans embrace him above all else, while he's in the midst of a self-destructive battle with drug abuse, almost as if their support is a way of cheering on his impending doom. We can make the case that it is the Holywood ideology circling around again. If he dies while on the cover of magazines and at the height of his fame, he will be a martyr and another Lamb of God. Omega's job is to push this agenda of self-destruction and drug abuse onto the society as a way to dumb and dull them down, but we get the sense that underneath it all, he's trying to also reveal a cautionary tale about how the same people that love you today will just as quickly leave you tomorrow once you are no longer on top, leading us to track 3, Mechanical Animals. This song sums up the landscape of mechanical animals. The people in this society are more machine-like than human, doing what they are programmed to do, without any sort of coloring outside the lines. Lyrics like, "If we cry, we will rust," drives the point home about the machine-like aspect of these people. Inside, they still have fragments of their humanity remaining, but they cannot showcase true emotions in fear of being outcasted. The ending of the song reveals Alpha dropping his guard and letting us in on his true feelings. "This is not me, I'm not mechanical, just a boy playing the suicide king." Alpha establishes distance between himself and the society and his fans with this remark. He is not one of them, but playing one just like an actor on TV would portray a villain. The track 4, Rock is Dead. Now, Omega returns on this song, creating a catchy little number that will serve as both an anthem and eulogy for the landscape of rock and roll. God is in the TV, signaling the worship of the famous, and the rock genre is being corrupted and sold out, hence it is dying. Everything that it once stood for, originality, actual rebellion, and a voice to the disenfranchised, has now evaporated in favor of a sonic trap to cash checks and corrupt the impressionable. Track 5, Disassociative. Now, disassociative symbolizes the internal civil war going on within Alpha regarding his emotions. He feels as if he'll never escape the prison of being contained within the public persona of Omega, like he's forever lost, floating like a dead astronaut in the enormity of the universe. Now, the next minute or so, I'm going to go off on a tangent that does not have so much to do with the summary of these albums, but I cannot help it, because this song is one of my top 10 all-time Marilyn Manson tracks. In particular, what I'm referring to is in the final minute and a half of the song. I just want everyone to take a listen to the absolutely amazing conclusion of the song. It's just like, holy shit, it's so good. From the background vocals that sound like a choir of fallen angels, to the kick-ass drums that showcase the most human quality contained on this entire record, to the intensity of Manson's voice conveying one of his most personal messages on the whole album, to lastly the sci-fi rocket ride that the guitar takes the listener on, to me it is simply beyond legendary. I still cannot believe that this song was never released as a single, and it's just one of those jams that gets better with each and every listen. The vocal cadence that Manson uses when saying "dead astronaut in space" reminds me of a distress call of sorts that an astronaut would make when knowing that his equipment was failing and he was doomed to crash, as if he's radioing back to base, letting them know that he's screwed. I could not recommend the song highly enough, and to this day, I think it is one of the most diverse outputs of Marilyn Manson's entire career. Track 6, The Speed of Pain. Now, this song sums up the disillusionment of Alpha. The good never seems to last, and the bad times seem never ending. The speed of pain isn't only about his emotional battle, but also the race of his excessive lifestyle, showering himself in wave after wave of drugs and alcohol, using these substances as a tool to numb his feelings so the sellout does not seem so bad. And the parts of himself that are stuck in the past with coma temporarily become manageable. Now, the final line of the song, "Hope We Die Holding Hands," is a revelation of his no-win situation. Adam slash Alpha wants the impossible. Coma is already unattainable due to her death. And while the drugs make him feel closer to her, he could use all the drugs in the world, but it will not bring her or his sense of belonging back. Leading us to track 7, Post-Human. JFK references return for the first time since Holywood's conclusion. As I covered earlier, JFK was a deity in the Holywood celebritarianism society, and the lyric about being perfect like Kennedy draws a comparison to Omega being egged on by his followers to do what it takes to become godlike. Now, you and I, as the listener, know from the groundwork we covered with these albums that the only way that could happen is to become as famous as possible and then die while you're on top of the public zeitgeist, therefore transcending humanity for a messiah-like status. Which brings us to track 8, I Want to Disappear. I Want to Disappear follows Omega's de-evolution, living down to the destructive expectations that his audience has put on him. Extreme drug use, deviant sexual escapades, and an all-out downward spiral into recklessness. These events put the pretty ones on the same status as Omega, one where he disappears into a fragment of their short-sighted conditional acceptance that, when it's all said and done, will leave him worse off than ever before. Bringing us to track 9, I Don't Like the Drugs, But the Drugs Like Me. Here we have another shallow but marketable glam jam from Omega. Now, even though the title and the sonic aspect of the song may sound mindless and catchy like a traditional pop song, lyrically it conveys a darkness and social commentary that is way more insightful when you dig into it. Omega may be justifying the drug use of himself and his followers, but he poses the question of what else would be the alternative. In this society, they are raised to be nothing more than consumers who are told what to buy and what to believe. So would falling out into self-destruction or drug addiction be any worse an alternative? That is the conundrum Manson leaves us with on this track. Also, a visual cue in the music video shows the Omega character being strapped into a crucifix of televisions and launching into the sky, a hearkening back to A Crucifixion in Space from Holywood. Track 10, New Model 15. On this song, Omega reveals his fake slash marketable nature to his followers, but it is far from a deal breaker in their eyes, considering his fans are just like him in a sense, hollow and disposable. They lack identity as well, and we can assume, based on the term mechanical animals, that they are simply projections with hand-picked ideals and morals spoon-fed to them from their society and its predetermined agendas, which would very much make them user-friendly. Track 11, User-Friendly. Now, on User-Friendly, we find one of the strongest dual metaphors on the entire album, dancing between detached relationships and justified drug use. A disposable sequence all around. Lyrics point to opportunistic sex in order to get ahead, with no thought paid towards real connection, tossing it to the side in favor of convenience. In the drugs metaphor, the whole not in love, but going to fuck you until something better comes along, that ideology works in a way of justifying bad behavior out of a lack of better options. Addiction and decadent behavior is a way of life, since Holywood and the land of mechanical animals are a dying culture that only breeds worse and worse versions of itself, like a Xerox that becomes more and more degenerated every time it's copied. And this takes us to track 12, Fundamentally Loathsome.
Love, you're not now.
This lyric, along with the declarations of numbness, white, and the dead blank slate of emotions a colorless world can bring, show Alpha as someone on the brink of defeat. He has lost his place in this world, hanging on for something that cannot be accomplished, something that has already passed him by without any recourse of return. Any form of love he is running into is nothing like the real thing that he once experienced. It's merely a passing of time. Therefore, we can gather based on the vibe and the final section of these lyrics that death is on its way for our protagonist, since his lack of purpose and self-worth continues to grow, and it keeps drowning him in a form of self-destructive quicksand. And this brings us to track 13, The Last Day on Earth. The time is almost here for both the destruction of the ways of the mechanical animals and also of Alpha slash Omega. The corruption, hollow minds, and empty spirits have descended into a Sodom and Gomorrah style of society, where the extremes of excess is dragging them closer to apocalyptic doom by the second. Anything pushed to an unhealthy level can lead to severe consequences, and what we as listeners are about to witness is that very cataclysmic event, where this soulless, technology-riddled society, whether knowingly or unknowingly, invalidated their own purpose, leaving their humanity by the wayside, welcoming on an emotionless android existence, which of course is not sustainable long-term. Alpha, however, seems to be somewhat welcoming this end along, feeling like it will finally reunite him with Coma. Lyrics like, "I'm so empty here without you, and we'll be together when the planet dies. I know it's the last day on Earth. We'll never say goodbye." All support this notion. So while the society of mechanical animals are finally at the brink of crumbling due to their twisted ways, Alpha welcomes it with open arms, knowing when it's all said and done, he finally regains his sense of belonging through Coma. Which brings us to the final track on this record, track 14, Coma White. With the Holywood slash mechanical animals landscape having been finally defeated by their own desire for escapism, corruption, and hero worship debauchery, we find this track functioning as a final epilogue, putting a final cap on the past two records. As Holywood had Coma Black, we now have Coma White. After Adam lost Coma thanks to her succumbing to the pressures of Holywood, aka the perfect world, Adam was repackaged as a product that this perfect world could sell. But now at this record's conclusion, we see that while the powers that be in Holywood thought integrating him into their society as a drug-addled, self-destructive influencer would be a benefit of rebellion prevention, in actuality, it only backfired and accelerated their society's downfall. The lesson Adam slash Alpha finds out the hard way is, all the way back at the beginning of Holywood, he wanted to be accepted, and when he realized that was not going to happen, without taking a revolutionary stand and changing the status quo, he inadvertently was always in the shadow of Holywood, even at his most rebellious. Now, having gone through quite a voyage of self-discovery and personal loss, he comes to find out the greatest lesson the hard way, that trying to be anyone else or to fit into somebody else's idea of what acceptable is, was the root of his every problem. And you can drug yourself into different ways of thinking or use substances to mask your problems and try to blend in, but none of those things will correct the initial problem. They will not save you from yourself. The only way to truly save yourself is to put yourself first. Now, I don't mean that in some creepy, narcissistic predator sense, but in a strong stance of self-empowerment, where if the societal herd is heading one way, a way perhaps you do not agree with, do not resent it because you aren't included. Do not desire to fit in with their programming in fear of being an outcast, but have the courage to forge your own path for yourself. Not doing it to gain acceptance, not doing it to appeal to others in any way, but as a true choice of individuality and personal sovereignty at the highest degree. Sadly, this epiphany came much too late for Adam, and now death has finally come to his own door. And now this brings us to the hidden track on the album, track 15. And this track essentially recaps everything in a succinct fashion. Omega in its traditional meaning being, quote-unquote, the end, and Alpha in context meaning the beginning, indicates that Adam's story in the triptych is over, as we've experienced both the beginning with Adam slash Alpha in Holywood and the end with Omega in Mechanical Animals. I know many people online had theories that the Adam character was the protagonist in all three albums of the triptych, but my friends, based on this information, as well as the tarot card sequence to come, it becomes pretty damn clear that Adam's direct involvement in the triptych is over. Now, when I first announced this summary video at the end of my Holywood analysis, I said this would be a much shorter video. Well, as you may have guessed by now,
the lie detector determined that was a lie.
Now we will be getting into Antichrist Superstar. The death of Coma at Holywood's conclusion and the death of Adam at the end of Mechanical Animals now gives way to the Worm. He's an individual who is suppressed by similar tropes that Adam dealt with in Holywood. This new stage of societal dogma is personified by the term beautiful people. However, as the Worm matures and realizes he will never fit into their quote-unquote perfect world that is run by the beautiful people, he decides to embrace the role of a destroyer or an antichrist, where Adam slash Omega try to show a different path for the world's evolution and spirituality growth. The Worm turned disintegrator goes on a scathing route of mirroring this society and its hypocrisy, capitalizing on the excesses of it before eliminating it all and himself due to an overwhelming need for breaking this corrupt cycle. So let's dig deeper into this final amazing chapter of the trilogy. The background information of this record in particular revolves around the main character's transformation from a lost, weak, and rejected person to his evolved state, becoming a reborn, adored, rabble-rouser rock star that eventually turns into a fallen angel or an antichrist. This is represented with three separate cycles on the album. Cycle 1, the Hierophant, 2. Inauguration of the Worm, and 3. Disintegrator Rising. A worm was chosen to represent the character at his early stages, where he is trying too hard to appeal to the outside world for acceptance, and he continues on this failing cycle until a metamorphosis has to occur. Worms and insects are often looked down upon for being considered creepy and their small and disgusting nature. This symbol perfectly sums up the traits of our protagonist when the album starts to unfold. So here we are at Cycle 1, The Hierophant. Track 1, Irresponsible Hate Anthem. Track 1 is a prophecy of what is to come. The track showcases the worm already at his evolved state of being the dirty rock star, which we will soon encounter on the second phase of the record. Lyrically, this song is a scathing assault on everything this society stands for. This future version of our main character is very outspoken against folks with victim mindsets. He even threatens to blacken their eyes, beat them with sticks, and states it's their own fault due to their lack of backbone and willpower to stand up for themselves and shift their circumstances. This song is a rally cry against societal standards, slave-minded / follower mentality, and those who feel that their quote-unquote side is a righteous one. When our protagonist claims, "I don't need to choose a side," it is his way of announcing his individuality, which, in his mind, makes him superior to everyone who tries so hard to live up to everyone else's standards instead of inventing their own. He despises these types of people and wants to boldly distance himself from them with the declarations contained in the song, leading us to track 2, The Beautiful People. This marks the true beginning of the record, when the worm was just as lost and afraid of being an outcast as the people referenced on track 1. The Beautiful People is a metaphor for the societal standards and landscape that the worm has to live amongst. They are equally obsessed with beauty, status, and religion, using materialism, social hierarchies, and self-righteousness, since they follow a monkey-see, monkey-do mentality. All too obsessed with the outside world and what it will think of them if they do not toe the predetermined line. Shot at capitalism points to the idea that the more you acquire also increases your value as a person. Manson views both this and materialism as a form of extremism that is essentially an updated fascist attitude. He condemns this by referring to them as apes and mocking the notion of this being a free and beautiful society, when all they know how to do is be slaves to their masters and imitate one another. However, this commentary is only told after the worm's failed attempt to find a place of solace amongst them. At first, he wished to be one of them, accepted under these conditions. But after he was discarded and finally accepted the fact that he will never be one of the beautiful people, he comes out with the blistering attitude that we find on this track. And he soon seeks another fix to ease his alienation. Track 3, Dried Up, Tied, and Dead to the World. The initial lyrics, as I mentioned earlier, point back to Omega, yet they also showcase the state of mind that the worm finds himself in when analyzing the surroundings he's trying to overcome. Fake people ready to get ahead by any means necessary. The worm is searching for an alternative to their way of operation, seeking something that he himself can believe in. The first detour he takes on this search is one involving sex and drugs. Drugs give him a short-lived feeling of empowerment and self-worth, but the effects don't last. This is referenced directly by the "I am anything when I'm high" phrase. Without the high, he's the same old beaten down and discarded person that he has always been. Also, he reaches both similar heights and impermanence with kinky and casual sex and lust, leading to an escape rather than a solution to his feeling of being outcast and misunderstood. The letdown of these experiences force him to search for another avenue to obtain what he is looking for. Track 4, Tourniquet. The final song on the initial cycle. The worm has found another path to hopefully find his place and stop his seeking, with a carefully crafted relationship. Yet based on the lyrics, as the song progresses, it seems to be more of a surface-level connection than anything that truly makes him feel at ease and accepted for who he is. The flies will lay their eggs metaphor displays the inevitability that this relationship won't last, no matter how much care is taken to preserve it. Also, flies tend to lay eggs in things that are dead, which tells you all you need to know about the type of relationship the worm has found himself in. The use of tourniquet doubles as a metaphor for stopping the bleeding in terms of the failing relationship, and in terms of drug use, which the worm is no stranger to, it makes for a more accessible way to inject your chosen high. Both a drug-induced high and a toxic codependent relationship will lift you like an angel before crashing you down to the depths below.
Yeah.
these lyrics indicate a form of abuse or neglect stemming from this connection he is in, which leads him to further fall into self-doubt and loss of identity, limiting his growth and stunting his willpower. The phrasing used throughout the song gives me the impression it is a situation that continued on well past its welcome, but when finally dealt with, the worm demands its long overdue ending. The last lines in the song here reveal our protagonist banishing this person and their suffocating influence on him, pointing out, "I never believed in me, I am your tourniquet," stating his rise in self-doubt and confusion is the product of this other person's impact on his life, and not a true reflection of his own lack of will and purpose. After clearing this situation out of the way, he reaches the next step in his evolution. Cycle 2, Inauguration of the Worm. Cycle 2 advances us along into a further stage of our protagonist's progression. He's leaving behind his lesser nature in order to recreate himself into a superior being that he himself can be proud of. But this type of change is not all the sunshine and rainbows it's cracked up to be. As we will discover, much of this forthcoming change takes a sinister turn. The next track deserves some extra focus since its metaphor is oftentimes understated. Track 5, Little Horn. The Little Horn is a biblical reference in the book of Daniel. In one of his visions, the prophet Daniel sees a little horn that grows out of a terrible beast. The emergence of the little horn, its unusual form, and its behavior caused Daniel to wonder. To get a better understanding of what the little horn symbolizes, both in this record's context and biblically, we need to take a look at Daniel's complete vision. The prophet saw four beasts, which represent four kingdoms. The first three represent Persia, Babylon, and Greece. The fourth and final that Daniel sees is, in his mind, the most troubling. He describes it as terrifying, frightening, and quite powerful. This fourth monster has bronze claws, large iron teeth, with which it uses to annihilate its prey. Daniel sees that this beast has 10 horns, and as he ponders the meaning of the horns, a little horn begins to grow from the midst out of the 10. This little horn is unusual as it emerges. Three of the original horns are plucked out. Daniel sees that the little horn has eyes like a human being and a mouth that speaks boastfully. The boastful words of the little horn continue until the day of judgment, and at that time, the beast is slain and its body is thrown into a blazing fire. Daniel is troubled by this vision, and an angel explains it to him. The beast's 10 horns are 10 kings who will arise from that kingdom. The little boastful horn with a human mouth and eyes represent a specific king. At his rise to power, the original kings will fall. This evil king, aka the Little Horn, will speak against the Most High and oppress his people, and he will exert oppressive power. These traits go hand in hand with the prophesied Antichrist that the Bible explains will arrive during the quote-unquote end times. The Antichrist will be a world leader, especially noted for his blasphemies and the scope of his abuse of power. The Antichrist will make his move to the top at the expense of three of those prior leaders, and he will eventually wield global authority. A true tyrant, the Antichrist will seek to control every aspect of life, and he will even demand to be worshipped. Now, circling back to the record, many of these traits in that Bible story I just touched on are foreshadowing to the traits that the worm will acquire in the next sequence of the record. These attributes include tyrannical power, boastful speaking out against society and spiritual authority, a demand to be worshipped, and ushering along the fall of the prior kings, aka established order. We can see why Mr. Manson rested on this symbol to guide us along the first part of the second sequence, as it sums up in a nutshell what is about to unfold as the record continues. No longer will the worm look towards the established order of society and spirituality for his answers. In fact, he's hell-bent on forming his own standards, even at the cost of killing off his old self. This track never fails to make the famous line from Fight Club pop into my head, "It's only after we lost everything that we are free to do anything." Now that the worm has finally thrown away his old self, the metamorphosis is underway, leading us to track 6, Cryptor Kid. Using the line about when you are a worm, it's hard to learn the number 7. 7 here is a numerical representation of heaven. Manson is explaining when he's a worm, or in his lesser stage of development, it is hard to understand what it takes to reach acceptance among the beautiful people or the status quo. And every time he looks outside, aka seeks an alternative, he's hurting those who care about him and shelter him as they don't relate to his experience. As we touched on in Tourniquet, those in his life seem to keep him where they want him in a sense, whether consciously or unconsciously, under their scope of control and understanding. But the worm has come to realize that this exploration of new esoteric or outside the lines thoughts and feelings change him and allows him to grow. Cryptorchidism is a condition where one or both of the testicles fail to drop into the nutsack, and background vocals can be heard in that track that say, "I wish I had my balls." And no, I am not making that up. Just listen closely. This is a direct metaphor for the worm's situation. He wishes this metamorphosis would occur immediately instead of through a more elongated process. If he, quote-unquote, had his balls, he'd get instant power and gratification to overcome the less desirable traits he wishes to outgrow. The end of the song, which has the repetition of "prick your finger, it is done," indicates the next level of transformation he seeks is now complete. He's dawning into a new stage of personal power that he will use to his advantage to both build himself up and cut down all that he opposes. Track 7, Deformography. This sequence of lyrics not only points to the past, but the current. Our protagonist was previously in a societal trap laid out by the beautiful people's agenda, trying to be the square peg that fits in the round hole, only to eventually give up that pursuit and find his new calling, rock stardom. He is now Mr. Superstar. The tables have turned. The Worm has become a rebellious rock star, using his platform to forge his own form of morals and idealism that rivals what he was once taught to be. He's even cautioning those who will soon follow him not to fall in too hard, not to become like he's becoming, not to change in the way he's changed. Take this as both a warning and a challenge. As we will soon see, he openly admits to using his newfound fame to destroy as well as create. His method of attack is turning his former detractors into fans, who will follow his lead and throw away their beliefs in order to adhere to his viewpoint. Mr. Superstar is getting off on the newfound respect, adoration, and attention that he's found his way into. And just like Adam in Holywood, the real test coming is whether he's going to hold true to his own principles or dissolve into all the pitfalls of corruption that he will soon face along the way. Track 8, Worm Boy. Track 8 marks the first trace of self-doubt-tinged reflection since the metamorphosis has occurred. Despite the changed appearance and improved circumstances, he still has moments that harken back to the same type of discontentment and comparisons to the status quo he's been trying to escape. The self-critical condition of his past has not washed away, and with lyrics such as, "When you get to heaven, you will wish you're in hell," indicate another recurring theme with Holywood, fighting to obtain something or someplace new, only to realize it's not what you really wanted or thought it would be. This back-and-forth pendulum swing of individuality versus measuring up to outside standards will continue to resurface as we go on. Track 9, Mr. Superstar. On this track, we get a glimpse into the minds of our protagonist's legion of fans. The verses showcase their attitude towards him, and it clearly expresses an unhealthy level of fandom and hero worship. But when the chorus hits, the perspective shifts back into Mr. Superstar. His goal in finding his own path and rising above the standards of the beautiful people are once again similar to Adam's in wanting to make an alternative, but now he recognizes the mindless worship he's getting is not fulfilling beyond the surface level pleasures. In fact, he's reaching gnosis, perhaps for the first time, seeing things as they really are. He's becoming the new standard, and instead of being an individual, those who adore him are merely shifting their focus from what they used to worship onto him. They are not receiving his real message. They continue on playing monkey see, monkey do. This breeds a new level of disgust, despair, and hatred inside him. Mr. Superstar admits this is not what he wanted. This sentiment is most vividly expressed via live performances on the Dead to the World tour. Now that he's understood his message is not being received, he digs wholeheartedly into his revenge bag. Knowing he cannot inspire or save anyone who is not willing to do the work and change into their true will and individuality. Therefore, the one-way ticket to both self and external destruction has been punched and will soon unfold. Track 10, Angel with the Scabbed Wings. This song showcases the loss of sympathy and morality, a full-fledged dive into nihilism. He reverts back to drugs and rock and roll cliches of out-of-control behavior. The lyrics just now shown reveal the game plan he's embarked on, posing as a savior, but really he's a taker, slowly destroying the followers who blindly cheer him on. The only way to overcome the system that's failed him and the people who have not understood him is to be willing to annihilate it. This idea of posing as a savior, but really doing the opposite, once again calls back to the biblical metaphors on this record with the Antichrist angle. That is almost to a T the way the events of the Antichrist fooling the world and tricking them into going against the ways of God is described in the Bible. He boastfully includes warnings to those he's on course for corrupting in his songs, but there is no stopping it now. Track 11, Kinderfeld. Final track on the second cycle of the album has some of the lyrics on this song peek back into some of the Worm's feelings before he changed into the influential nihilistic rock star. When I was a worm, thought I could not get through it. As the song progresses, we see a foreshadowing of the final evolution he's taking, the disintegrator, which is the chosen term synonymous for the Antichrist type of traits he is going to display. Lies have watered me, and now I have become the strongest weed. He points the finger back to the system and the people who discarded him and made this monster he's transformed into, a wicked desecrator hell-bent on burning down the world who never understood him. The society that breeds these types of wickedness and disenchantment in the world should only fear their own reflection, for it's themselves who create these types of psychos who snap out and commit the atrocities we see on the news, for example. It's their judgmental attitudes, materialistic criteria for being a have or a have not, and the lack of time and understanding given to allow people to truly find their own way in life is what leads to destructive attitudes. In a way, the world that will be eventually demolished by an Antichrist or whatever apocalyptic event that comes along only has themselves to blame. And that is the biggest takeaway I've received from this track. Enter Cycle 3, Disintegrator Rising. As Cycle 3 begins, I quickly want to reference the poem The Conquering Worm by Edgar Allan Poe. It contains similar tropes as the story unfolding in this record, as it portrays the world and human life in general as wild and filled with madness, only to end in the hideousness of death. Cycle 3 will reveal to us a conquering attitude as the worm turned angelic rock star is going to trade all the fringe benefits of stardom into a philosophical and spiritual battlefield. Track 12, Antichrist Superstar. Shed the skin to feed the fake is a sentence that functions as a summary to what brought us to this point. The fake outsiders, aka the beautiful people, directly caused his transformation of shedding his old skin. By chanting repent throughout the song, he's mocking the idea that these people, including his mindless followers, can be saved. The Hydra, historically speaking, is a multi-headed beast that once one head is cut off, more grow back, similar to the Little Horn prophecy from the Book of Daniel. This comparison made indicates our central character has a thirst for revenge that will not be quenched with anything less than the extinction of the old ways of thinking. He announces to see him or your beloved star for what he truly is. The Antichrist is almost here. Soon he will wield the power to erase everything he despises about the world. Track 13, 1996. Our Antichrist rock star proclaims, "Light a candle for the sinners and set the world on fire." He has begun his scorched earth revenge. First, burning down the illusions his followers had about him, and next, destroying the very system and social order that held him back his entire life. He is unleashing his pent-up hatred and rage as a new twisted art piece. The method being destruction as a form of creation. This is the moment where he shines a light on a lesson of extremism, as the elitist attitudes of rock and roll fans, occult practitioners, and materialists are just as blind and hollow as the worst extremism of Christianity and other religions. He condemns them all right here. Track 14, Minute of Decay. Minute of Decay reveals to us that despite the hard-boiled attitude and wreckage he's leaving in his wake, the Antichrist Superstar, aka Disintegrator, is dealing with his own emotional turmoil when it comes to the impending end of the world, or society as we know it. Even though he is the one bringing about this apocalyptic finale, these moments of sad, morbid reflection are not lost on him when it pertains to what could have been. If only he was accepted, or if only society was more understanding and inclusive. However, as the song progresses, the Disintegrator comes to the understanding that he will have to destroy himself also to complete his vengeance. Once this lesson is integrated, he wears the role of deceiver on his sleeve, bolder than ever before, eliminating any remnants of a facade or mask over his true, dark intentions. Openly proclaiming, "I'm on my way down, I'd like to take you with me." The apocalyptic tribulation has arrived, and the reflecting God is dealing out his most wicked form of justice. Track 15, The Reflecting God. Track 15 is essentially the soundtrack to the end of the world. Let's take a quick listen. Antichrist Superstar is using his unrivaled power and influence to quote-unquote be the new God. Only in his reign over mankind, there will be no salvation and no forgiveness. For the sole purpose of this Armageddon is to wipe the slate clean as a means to end everything for good or create an irrevocable change, depending on how you and I as listeners view the purpose of his mission. Is he another elitist tyrant, becoming everything he used to rally against? Or is he truly an avenging angel that had to go to such extremes to right the wrongs of society? I personally have my take on it, but I will stop myself from announcing my view as a means to encourage you to think about your own. I know, you might be screaming at your phone or your laptop right now, accusing me of copping out, but come on. I did all the heavy lifting here, meaning-wise, with 4 long-ass videos. I'd be violating one of the very cornerstone principles Marilyn Manson tried to convey with the triptych, which is to think for yourself. So let me know in the comments below your take on it. So is he the elitist tyrant or the avenging angel? Track 16, Man That You Fear. Now, Man That You Fear serves as an epilogue to all the events that transpired throughout the album. A recap after the season finale, if you will. And I can't miss the chance to shout out Trent Reznor's absolutely awesome work playing the Rhodes piano in the song. It is truly the musical heart and soul of this track. The Worm slash Disintegrator contemplates the past, recalling everything that led up until this point. His initial moments of existence, feeling loved, which as the years went on, and as he grew up in a sick society, that morphed into disenchantment and hatred, which eventually gave way to fear, as he became the Antichrist they had a hand in creating. He, in a way, is petitioning to us, claiming he has no choice but to do this. Then once again, reminds us that he was once loved before the circumstances mutated him into a monster. He demands the world crawl into the dark side, coming face to face with the mess they made, unable to run away from it, unable to be saved from it. The dogma that they poisoned all their children and therefore society with will not come to the rescue. These failed methods implemented by the beautiful people's civilization cycled on for far too long, like a broken record or a cut that never healed. Someone had to go this far, and another reprise of the line, I was born into this, once again shows us the viewpoint the Disintegrator is trying to perpetuate, but it's up to us to judge whether he is a reliable narrator or not. Was it really his fate or destiny to unleash this havoc, or is he still in his quote-unquote deceiver mode, as a father of lies like the biblical verses claim the Antichrist will be, therefore justifying his devastating actions with final words? Well, that's another huge question that the listener is best off answering for themselves.
Yeah.
this planet's destruction has been carried out, leaving everyone wishing their life was just a dream, something they could wake up out of and relive if only they knew what they know now. But instead, they are resigned to feeling what the worm felt way back when, with no one left to hear you scream and nobody left for you. The disintegrator has turned the tables and pulled the plug on the beautiful people and their ways of being, living up to the Oppenheimer quote,
"Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds."
Track 99. This was a hidden track on the album that only played after a multitude of silent tracks. The sentiment here is that another messiah or a rehashing of the same old cycle will only fail as well. The disintegrator, speaking in a demonic dialect of distortion, informs us that this punishment was deserved for both the world and himself. He recalls his initial attempts to shift the curve and save the day by presenting the alternative of individuality, but that failed, leading to the hell-like torment that they now have to endure. Once again, he's imploring that we are not victims, as this damnation was deserved, before delivering his final declaration of, "When you are suffering, know that I have betrayed you," taking the credit for bringing this malfunctioning pattern to its final end. Now, as you may have noticed, the same phrase opens the record, and now it also closes it, which signifies the occult image of a snake eating its own tail. Any sort of surviving principles of the ways of the beautiful people and its now collapsed ways of thinking and behavior will only be fated for a similar demise. Like Sisyphus, forever doomed to repeat unless a real change of mind, heart, and spirit occurs. The key to escaping such a terrible fate is self-honesty, self-realization, and an open-minded society which would allow those principles to be obtained for everyone, not just those in harmony with the status quo. And that, my friends, is probably the biggest takeaway from the entire triptych in my point of view. So that takes us to the tarot card aspect of this video. The reason for including this is to give a further underlying on what I laid out for you. That way, if any critics of my take on it are out there, they can read them and weep, as this Easter egg laid out in the Holywood artwork by Manson himself backs my views up quite well. The cards presented in the spread are the Magician, Devil, Emperor, Hermit, Fool, Justice, High Priestess, Hierophant, and Death.
And also, you can count The Hanged Man on the cover of Holywood because it is a prelude or the true step one in the spread. The reason for presenting them in this order is if you take the Holywood booklet, open it up, and fold it in a right-to-left sequence, each time you flip it over, one of the band members' photos appear next to their image on a corresponding tarot card. This indicates the proper sequence to interpret the tarot with. And I will show you a flash image of what I mean. Before I dive into a quick rundown of the symbols of the cards and how they connect, I feel with the nature of the internet, I have to do a quick disclaimer. All three albums are represented at various points of the tarot spread. Put together, it symbolically tells the entire layout of the triptych. All tarot cards contain many messages within each card, so some of these traits may ring more true for other people's interpretation as we go one by one down the cards. But it is easy to see how these symbols connect with what we have unraveled with the analysis section. I will be doing the reading with my Rider-Waite deck, which is the most commonly used deck amongst readers, although there are a few other worthwhile decks also. In addition to displaying images of the Rider-Waite cards, I will be showing the tarot artwork for the Manson cards as well, so you can see both editions for yourself. Even though the cards have different artwork, the meaning of the cards remain the same. This will be a very expedited reading since this video is probably going to be over 3 hours long. Therefore, keep in mind there are other tie-ins that could be discussed with what we're about to get into, but for brevity's sake, I'm going to stick to the main components instead of getting too much into the lesser important parallels. So the first set of cards I will be talking about are most prevalent to the Holywood story. The Hanged Man. Technically, this card is not in the spread, but since it was on the album cover, I wanted to touch on it quickly. With the Hanged Man on the cover, it serves as a backdrop for the reading, just as God Eat God did the same tone setting for Holywood as an opening track. Among the many symbols and meanings for the Hanged Man is a state of being confined in a set of circumstances. Immediate mobility of action is not possible. As the imagery on the Rider-Waite card displays, the man is hanging upside down. However, the yellow beam of illumination around his head signifies a need to strongly think about the situation you are in now versus where you want to be going forward. This card numerically represents the 12 steps of initiation through which every man or woman must pass. The celebritarianism religiosity that Adam had to grow up under was the stuck situation this card is referring to. Also, you can make a connection of Jesus's link to not only the celebritarian religion, but the comparison Manson was making with the late 1990s, early 2000s outspoken Christian America, with Mr. Manson's use of putting himself in a Christ-like pose on his Hanged Man card. The Hanged Man is the first glimpse we have into Adam's journey, living in the shadow of a world that honors death as salvation, and he must consider if he's willing to do what it takes to break away from the knot of that society, or if he's content to remain safely in place and fall in line among those who perpetuate this ideology. New perspectives are another cornerstone of this card, and Adam definitely donned a new series of beliefs which led him on his rebellion. The Hanged Man ultimately signals to a moment of suspension that we can turn into an advantage by refining our plans in greater detail, increasing self-knowledge, and doing inner work. Often, this will let us know that the time is not right for making a decision and that the situation or viewpoint needs to develop further. Moving on to the second card, technically the first card in the spread, the Magician. Technically, this marks the actual beginning to the spread. The Magician is also the number one card in the tarot, which represents the whole of potential and the first real step towards initiation or individuation, depending on what lens you look at it with. The Magician stands before a table on which upon it are laid a wand, a cup, a sword, and a pentacle, which represent the minor arcana of the tarot and the four elements. He is about to draw power from above to materialize his desires. Over his head is the cosmic symbol of eternal life and dominion, indicating the harmonious interaction of the conscious and the subconscious, idea and feeling, desire and emotion. For the magician, all is possible. Within the magician is a spirit that seeks to situate itself within the human realm and find solutions for material life problems. The magic wand is reaching up to the infinite for accomplishment, while the other hand reaches down to encourage the evolution of the lower kingdoms, and this unites both spirit and matter. The magician represents man's will in union with the divine, achieving the knowledge and power to bring desired things into manifestation through self-awareness. This card also indicates the necessity of deciding. The magician shows that a new beginning can be made, even though the magician still has a long road to travel ahead of him. These traits sum up Adam's rebellion and initial stages of his desire for coma to a T. He's chasing something new to discard the old standard. The third card is the Devil. The Devil appears as a tempter. He sits on a half cube, which signifies the half knowledge of what is on the visible sensory side of reality. His right hand is raised up, giving the sign of black magic. In his left hand, he holds the smoldering torch of destruction. The inverted pentagram denoting evil intent is inscribed above his forehead. Chained to the half cube are two nude people related to the Lovers card. The tail of the man represents the incorrect use of the signs of the zodiac, while the woman's tail resembles a bunch of grapes, suggesting the misuse of the wine of life. There is no devil except of man's own creation, and here it is evident that mankind is chained by their own wrong choices. However, the chains around their necks are loose and can be removed at will. The Devil, having once been an angel, reveals with his torch his profound desire to climb back from his cave and out to the heavenly cosmos. In a similar fashion, the human soul, buried in the carnal body, has a profound desire to ascend back to its origin, the creator deity. This reminds us that any initiate to achieve illumination should not refuse his animal side, but accept it, honor it, and guide it to angelic light. In all cases, this card directs us toward our personal nature and encourages us to not hide behind a mask or fall into temptations that will set us back. Adam's many temptations include his forbidden love with coma, giving in or selling out the revolution in order to dodge the mounting retaliation coming his way after tearing down the revered ways of order. So Adam's devil is the struggle between staying true to his will and views versus the benefits of bending the knee and becoming everything he used to despise out of cowardice and external pressure. Card 4, the Emperor. The Emperor sits on his throne, commanding and stately. His key is number 4, and this indicates all that is stable. 4 is also the number of the elements: air, earth, fire, and water. There are 4 seasons in each year, 4 points to the compass, and 4 rivers in the Garden of Eden. The Emperor is in the consolidation of his authority. No more effort in exploration is necessary for him, as his views are already established. He stands for domination of the material world, authority, paternity, and the regulation of life by law. The Emperor's reality obeys him. He is the master of his territory, his body, his intellect, and his passions. He will easily represent the father figure as the central constituent element of the personality. In the triptych, Coma's father Jack, who is described in chapter 10 of Manson's Holywood novel as the ruler of Holywood, so he's a president/king type of character. He represents the law and order of the land, and therefore is the emperor. Its position in the spread is consistent with the final cycle of the Holywood album, The Fallen, where Adam's revolution is stymied, Coma's father separates her from Adam's love, and he forcefully tears apart the rebellion in a show of power to restore organization towards celebritarianism and to stamp out Adam's societal alternative. Number 5, the Hermit. The Hermit stands isolated on a mountain peak, holding up a lantern to guide those below. The lantern he carries may be considered a symbol of knowledge. He holds it, shedding a light over the past, as would a man of experience. This light can be a secret knowledge, or, to the contrary, a source of knowledge offered to the disciples who are looking for it. The hermit illuminates the path. Just as the card bears an ambivalence between action and reception, this light can be active, like an appeal for awakening the consciousness, or receptive, like the beacon of a lighthouse. Only those who dare, do, and keep silent can see the light of the hermit's lamp. The hermit carries a staff to use on the narrow path of initiation and individuation. His cloak is the mantle of discretion, as it protects truth from profane eyes. He is ready to help anyone who cries for his light. He remains on the heights of the peak throughout long nights of spiritual darkness. The hermit may have discovered the elixir of long life, may have even touched eternity, been both poor and rich, having known death and rebirth. He appeals to that part of us that may be eternal, and he inspires us to go through the trials of life courageously. This card often symbolizes a crisis that cannot be avoided, a profound change that needs to be both confronted and accepted. It evokes the idea of a teacher or a guide, but in a crisis, there is a possibility that the hermit must renew himself or die. This card symbolizes an inner solitude and the secret dark space where a spiritual transformation is prepared. The solitude of the hermit is fitting to both Adam and Coma, as they've been torn apart by the established order, but their paths end up being split off in two different directions. This imposed isolation and failing of Adam's rebellion leads Coma to taking her own life, as told in Count to Six and Die. Whereas for Adam, he is bound to the principles of regrowth and spiritual transformation that the hermit represents. He can no longer continue as he was, since the lantern of illumination points to his past, reminding him of the failures, traumas, and loss he's encountered up until this point. With his Coma dead, his revolution gone, and the guns, God, and government order forcing him to sell out and be a puppet in their game, Adam must become something new, something unrecognizable, which ends Holywood and leads us into mechanical animals. Card 6, The Fool. Now this one begins the events of Mechanical Animals. Here we have an individual about to step off the edge of a cliff. He represents many things: boundless energy, disorder, chaos, seeking, and even the fundamental creative urge. The Fool also signals to inexperience, which certainly can be foolish. He faces the direction of the unknown. If he were to take another step, there would be no clear sign of where it would lead. The key phrase of the Fool could be, "All paths are my path." The Fool depicts the eternal traveler wandering through the world with no ties or nationality. He could also be viewed as a pilgrim making his way to a sacred site. Or in the reductive outlook, he could be a madman wandering towards his own destruction. The Fool carries a white rose, indicating that he is free from traditional complexes and judgments. Unbound by common taboos, because he has abandoned all typical viewpoints in favor of finding his own. The little white dog at his heels shows us that nature is glad to follow along in man's wake, or alternatively, he can function as an inner voice that shows an alternative to the Fool's initial gut instinct ways of thought. The Fool, regardless of his positive or negative side, evokes an enormous burst of liberating energy. It is a symbol of a process that is moving forward. The Fool is about to pass into the cycle of life through which each soul must journey. Think of it as a spirit facing unknown possibilities of self-expression as he first enters the world. In other words, this card poses the ultimate question of knowing where this energy is headed and toward what end is it applying strength. Is it toward light or darkness, positive or negative? The true test is discovering where, because everybody must journey forward. Choose between good and evil, but only if he has no philosophy, no higher direction, does the Fool truly become foolish and live down to his name. This symbol of the Fool in a nutshell describes the struggle between Alpha and Omega, the journey of being somewhere new, somewhere alien, trying to navigate the waters of the unknown while the higher self fights off temptations and the lower nature indulges in them. The yin and the yang of good and bad, vibrant outward expression versus emotional numbness and spacious solitude. The Fool is Adam's new beginning, but as we discover in the album and the next couple tarot cards that spell it out, Adam slash Alpha very much vacillates between the positive and negative qualities expressed within the symbols of the Fool. Card 7, Justice. The symbol of fulfillment. Justice balances our lives with her scales. Justice is seated between the positive and negative forces indicated by the pillars. Her sword is lifted in defense of justice, and no one can escape it. It points upward, indicating victory, and it is two-edged to convey that action destroys as well as builds, that the false must be cut away from the accurate. Her sword is essential because it is used to separate us from the useless. In her left hand are the scales, always related to balanced judgment. Justice is moved by wisdom. The scales indicate that she is weighing our spirituality. In this sense, justice can be seen as the witness of our inner God, who urges us to evaluate ourselves. Are we just in dealing with ourselves? Are we merciful toward ourselves and others? This key is of the Great Mother, through whose love, care, and perfect justice the children of men may achieve equilibrium. The two scales are a direct connection to the two sides of Alpha and Omega, the desire for fame and acceptance versus the need to truly be seen and heard, be emotionally and spiritually understood. Omega slash Alpha's album-long battle between the two extremes is perfectly personified within this card. Card 8, The High Priestess. When this card appears in a man's reading, depending on the spread, it can represent the perfect ideal woman that men dream of. In Adam slash Alpha's case, this is Coma. The High Priestess is a symbol of purity and reveals the part inside us of purification and trust. The High Priestess can be seen as an initiator or a sorceress. She oftentimes has been incorporated into the great religious figures, the Virgin Mary and the goddess Isis, a magical source of fertility and transformation. She displays the pure spirit that dwells within each of us and summons us to communicate with this incorruptible divine power. She is the daughter of the moon and wears the symbol of a full moon on her head, with a waxing and waning image of the moon on each side. She is the eternal feminine. She is spiritual enlightenment, inner illumination, the link between the seen and the unseen. The High Priestess is seated between two pillars from the Temple of Solomon, the black pillar of Boaz, representing the negative life force, and the white one, Yakin, the positive life force. She holds on her lap a parchment of esoteric wisdom titled Torah, aka the Divine Law. The solar cross on her chest exhibits the balance of the positive and negative forces, the Alpha and Omega. Omega slash Alpha's ultimate purpose was to A, reunite with Coma, and B, establish a union between his opposing sides. As the ending of Mechanical Animals revealed, his failure to unify his duality and his unsuccessful attempt to recreate the bliss that he obtained previously with Coma led to his death. Yet in his death, he achieved his reunion with his deceased love, Coma White. This takes us to the events of Antichrist Superstar with the next card in the spread, the Hierophant. Here again, we have a figure seated between two pillars, repeating the theme of duality. These are the pillars of the Tree of Life from the Kabbalah, one representing mercy and the other severity. Or it might be said that the one on the right is law and the one on the left is the liberty to obey or disobey that law. Both are necessary for obedience. Through compulsion can never bring freedom, as a person must choose. The Hierophant is to incarnate divine unity and to teach it to the best of his ability. The crossed keys at the feet of the Hierophant, one gold and one silver, are the solar and lunar currents of energy. Two priests kneel before him. One wears the white lilies of thought, and the other wears the rose of desire. As a master of the sacred mysteries, the Hierophant wears the triple crown of the Pope. The lower representing the material world, the middle represents the formative world, and the top one represents the creative world. The symbol of three is repeated in his staff, revealing the realm of the spirit, body, and soul. Its number of five is the number of man and humanity. The Hierophant points to traditional teaching considered suitable for the masses. He is the reigning power of external religion. He could represent a present or future master or guide, and also symbolizes all the means used for communication. The Hierophant evokes a guided communication that knows undeniably where it is going. Some of these traits I just covered fit the worm and what he eventually becomes like a glove. The ideological war of mercy versus severity, his famed future as an influential communicator, his undeniable willpower, and his desire to take his esoteric viewpoints and boldly display them in an external sense. The Triple Crown also goes hand in hand with the three cycles on the album. But if we spin it around for a second, the Hierophant equally displays qualities that fit what the worm was disenchanted with and decided to fight against, such as its symbolized traditional teachings and pope-like characteristics. In a cool way, it showcases what the worm hates and what he becomes. And it's not a coincidence that throughout the voyage of Antichrist Superstar and its events, the worm turned disintegrator falls into the trap of becoming many of the things that he used to denounce. And for the final card in the spread, death. A skeleton in armor rides a white horse that tramples over a fallen king. He continues on near a child and a woman who turn away from him in dread. The bishop in a mitre, shaped like a fish, denotes the Piscean Age, which is about to end. Death carries with him a banner on which there is a five-petaled rose, symbolizing the life force. The river in the background indicates the circulation of the life force into materialization and out again. Unlike in Hollywood movies, the death card does not represent someone literally dying, unless in the odd exception of other tarot cards that also indicate death are overwhelmingly present in the same reading. What this card actually prompts us to see is death as a work of cleansing, an unavoidable change necessary for the renewal and the ascent that follows after it, one step at a time toward the total realization of the world's entire potential. The king has fallen, reminding us that kingdoms must inevitably fall. There is perpetual transformation, one aspect of which is death and birth. Death is a protest against stagnation. It is by this all changes for the better come to pass and old ideas fade. It is a process of elimination that works the ego like a field and tames it. No useless element is tolerated. Reductive concepts and value systems are swept away, and with them, the complicity that held us within our unrealized state or neurosis. All bonds of dependency are cut in order to recover our lost liberty. This change from a personal to a universal view is so radical that mystics often compare it to death. But don't forget, death is the twin brother of life. Creation necessitates its opposite, destruction. As the disintegrator escalated into his idealism, into the perils of fame, twisted decadence, and glorified self-destruction, his ultimate demise ushered in this wiping the slate clean that is symbolized by the death card. A rebirth can now take place, one that hopefully rights the wrongs of the past, but if not, will lead inevitably to another disintegrator slash antichrist that, like death, will press the reset button when things become too mindless, controlled, and emotionally hollow.
You know, generally good is what you like and evil is what you don't like. And everybody's going to have a different opinion. I'm sure to some people I'm evil. But to me, I just try and do what makes me happy. I don't try and do something to harm someone else, you know. But when you're trying to create something that's greater than everything around you, some people are going to be afraid and some people are going to suffer. But that's the price for greatness. So in the end, I don't really care what anybody says about me. To me, I am what I am.
Which one do I talk into? Okay, hi. Hi, everybody. The first time I saw Marilyn Manson, the person, he was walking a human like a dog on a chain leash. I saw a man unlike anyone I've ever saw before. His presence terrified me, aroused, intrigued, and inspired me. We became fast friends as the art of mischief without boundaries brought us closer together. The first time I saw Marilyn Manson, the band, I was blown away. In a time when America was fascinated with serial killers and celebrities instead of terrorism and selfies, he managed to captivate and challenge any audience in front of him with fear, desire, and above all, great songs. In the beginning, I was part of that audience. When the time came for me to be part of his art, I had no idea what I was in for. Over the course of 2 decades with him, I've seen some serious shit. From massive record sales to sold out gigs all over the planet, where seething hate of dullards never could eclipse the love and respect received from the diehard fans. Sure, having a ruthless early morning food fight and a rented minivan with $110 worth of breakfast from McDonald's was pretty fun. Playing in an amphitheater in Colorado with tripped up police security was terrifying. Not really. That's the thing about playing in Marilyn Manson. We were always ready to step it up. When it looked like rock and roll, sometimes life was getting a little boring. But any great army needs a leader to go into battle, and Manson has remained fearless, whether it was about pushing his art to the massive extremes or exposing the hypocrisy of people who routinely hide behind crosses and flags. We made a live video called Guns, God, and Government. Turn on the news. 15 years later, and America still hasn't reconciled that shit. He has never been afraid to change things and tear it all down just as fast. In his first AP cover story, Manson asked, "I think our band is simply America at its truest. It's like we are listening to a cassette tape of the end of the world. I just want to fast forward it and turn it up louder." Truth be told, I think you mean throwing the thing out the window of a moving tour bus a long time ago. At the end of the day, there is only one Antichrist Superstar, one mechanical animal, and only one almighty pale emperor. To be his friend, his brother, and a fan continues to be an honor. I will continue to wear this like a badge. Manson.
The last time that he gave me an award, he smashed it on the floor. Remember that? Back in Florida?
Hold this for a second.
Thank you. You guys are so short. But thank you to all of the fans and all of alternative press, because this is the only award that I will actually put on my shelf, because my shelf is mostly filled with baboon skulls and or Chinese kid skeletons, according to the words of... That was not meant in the way it sounded. It was meant in a worse way. And I couldn't have done it without my brother right here. Let's hear it for Twiggy. Because this is the greatest award ever. Thank you. Truly.
Okay, final thoughts. Now that all of the trilogy albums have been laid out in these videos, keep in mind there are other connections that either were not included due to time constraints or things that I was less than 95% clear on. So I omitted them from the final cuts for falling short of my personal video-worthy standard. But by all means, if you have any relevant information that you are privy to and happen to notice that those details were not discussed in my videos, feel free to drop them in the comment box below for us all to ponder over. Before signing off, I want to give a special thanks to the supporters who donated to the channel and commissioned this video topic within the past several months. Chastity Shell, Ben Moen, Anna Carolina Malatesta, and Mike from XRL7. And check out the cool web series that he has going on his channel. You all absolutely rock, as well as every other badass who has liked, subscribed, and commented on these videos, with either giving positive feedback to me, the video, or sharing your thoughts and experiences surrounding these albums. It goes a long way to keep this type of content going, because as fun as it can be, it's extremely time-consuming while juggling work and personal life responsibilities. So let it be known that you all made this happen, by far and away surpassing any expectations I had while making the first video in the series. So a big thanks to you all. And until next time, stay open-minded and self-realized.